32, Rachel O'Reilly, had been found brutally murdered in her own home at 2 p.m. on Monday, the 4th of October, 2004. The police believed she'd been killed between 9:30 and 10:30 a.m. They desperately needed witnesses and began to question anyone who might have been in the area.
Rachel would have been known in the community. It was a huge shock for something like that to happen to one of our own, so to speak.
In that area, nothing like that has ever happened before. And when we heard it was a young mother, two kids, just after dropping them to school, very, very unusual. Because like any murders that happen in Dublin, they're normally, 9 times out of 10, gang-related.
The attack was brutal and bloody. So the police believed that the murderer would have fled the scene covered in blood.
The police were tracing everybody and anyone that had a record. And I think for 20 miles around there, they took in anyone that they had suspicions of. They'd done a massive search.
But despite a widespread hunt, they didn't find any witnesses. And there was little to go on at the house either.
There was nothing left in the DNA analysis which was of any crucial interest to us when all the family, friends and people who had been in and out of the house that day, they were all eliminated.
The lack of DNA evidence led the police to draw their own conclusion about who may have murdered Rachel.
After the funeral, you pick up all the cards and that. And when it came to the flowers from Joe, there was this little card. And on the card were the stark words of "see you later, Joe." No mention of Rachel, no mention of love. It just was bizarre.
9 days after Rachel had been killed, the police finished their examination of the house and gave Joe his keys back. He then invited Rachel's family over because he told them he'd felt comforted by Rachel's presence in the house and he suggested it could help them too. But when they arrived, Joe launched into a graphic description of what exactly he thought happened on that fateful morning.
I was saying to myself, how could he know? Like, I was starting to think to myself, this is not adding up and that's not adding up. That. But you're afraid to take on board because the worst scenario in the world for us would be that it was him.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick. Good evening. We're happy to tell you that tonight's episode is brought to you by HelloFresh. Just go to HelloFresh.com/TCB to get $35 off on your first order.
Okay. So our episode today is A Husband's Rage, The Murder of Rachel O'Reilly. Now, the murder of kind and energetic mom of two, Rachel O'Reilly, which occurred in October 2004, shocked the community where she lived. The village of Naul in North Dublin countryside. At first, the horrific crime was believed to have been done by a burglar, but soon Rachel's husband Joe, a 32-year-old advertising executive, was under suspicion. Although Joe initially came across as an ordinary middle-class husband and father, his behavior after Rachel's murder was bizarre. Joe worked hard at his role of grieving widower. He begged the public for help to catch his wife's killer, and he was cooperative with police and in media interviews. But Rachel's family and friends became very uncomfortable with Joe's behavior and the odd graphic conversations he persisted in having with anyone that would listen about Rachel's murder. So by the time of Rachel's funeral, her family was genuinely concerned that Joe may have killed Rachel. But Rachel was loved, she was hardworking, and kind to everyone she met. Her death was a horrible act of violence, too. Sadly, she adored her husband, Joe. So if Joe did kill Rachel, this was really a cruel betrayal. Now, in this episode, we're going to discuss Rachel's life and her relationship with her husband, Joe. Then, the crime that took her life, the evidence, and the murder trial of Joe O'Reilly. Now, before the beer review, I'm going to thank some listeners for their 5-star reviews. And in case you're interested, stay tuned after our case discussion. We're going to have our new feedback segment today.
Yeah, that's been something you've been working on for a while.
A little while.
Looks like it'll be fun.
Yeah, I think so. So I'd like to thank Mary and Dutch Dwee, Anando, New Batgirl, and Lovey-Dovey15 for their 5-star reviews. Thank you and welcome to the brewery, guys.
Thank you. Come down to the quiet end with us.
What have we got for a beer?
Well, this is an Irish crime. As if you couldn't tell from the promo at the start. So I went ahead and did what everyone associates with Ireland for a beer, and I'm going to do Guinness. This is Guinness Extra Stout, which is brewed by Guinness Limited in Dublin. And this particular stout is an Irish dry stout. This is one of the most common stouts. It's lighter bodied. It keeps them on the highly drinkable side. They are usually a lower carbonation brew, served on a nitro system for that creamy effect. Everybody knows about the perfect head of Guinness, right?
I hadn't heard about it, but sure.
Okay. Bitterness comes from roasted barley and a generous dose of hops, although the roasted character is more noticeable. That's for sure. I don't consider this form of stout a very hoppy stout. On to the Guinness itself. It's a black beer with a thick tan head, roasted malt aroma, mostly coffee, a little sweet chocolate taste, and it's on the lighter side, even though you look at it and it's a pitch black beer and you think, oh, this is going to be some heavy damn beer, but it's not. It's pretty light, easily drinkable.
I always did think it was heavy.
But you'd be surprised.
I guess so.
So give it a try sometime.
Okay. Let's open it up.
Got it. Okay, Jilly, let's take these beers and our glasses down to the quiet end. And if you notice, it is really quiet tonight.
Well, yes.
No, I think that's because we've had like 30 inches of snow in the last few days. So everybody's busy digging out.
Yeah, or staying in their homes.
Yeah, who wants to go out on a night like this? Of course, it finally did stop snowing.
It did.
More to come, too. Anyway, let's start.
Okay. So, Rachel OBrien. She was born in October 1973 to a 17-year-old Dublin girl. Her birth name was Teresa Green. Now, her mother made the decision to give her baby for adoption to another family because she was young, unmarried, and she was unable to support her. So it was a really selfless decision.
It now, sounds like a well-made decision, too.
Yeah, 17, that's young.
17, no money, not much education.
Yeah, it would be a rough life.
It would be. So I would say she did the right thing.
Yeah, seems like it. And they were a nice family now. Rose and Jim Kalali. They were delighted to add baby Rachel to their family. They'd already adopted two boys, Declan and Paul, and they would actually go on to adopt two more children after Rachel, Anthony and Anne.
Five adopted kids.
Yep.
Now, those are special people, too, aren't they, that family?
Yeah, I really think so. Now, Jim was working really hard to establish his plumbing contractor business while Rose cared for the children in their home in Glasshaven Park. The family were church regulars, and they were popular in the area. Jimmy was an excellent cyclist who would be seen on his bicycle all over the Dublin countryside. Now, when Rachel went to school, she was really encouraged by her father to participate in sports. And she was athletic. She played basketball, hockey, softball. She did gymnastics, and she was a swimmer.
Yeah, I think basketball was her big sport because she was close to 6 feet tall.
Yeah, very tall.
Tall woman.
Mm-hmm. Also, softball she played in adulthood pretty well, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think she actually played with Joe on a couple of teams.
Right. She probably gave up the gymnastics when she got 5.5 feet tall or so.
Yeah, it gets harder as you get taller, I guess.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. Now, when Rachel was 14, her family immigrated to Perth, Australia. So, at the time, Ireland was experiencing an economic depression, and the promise of steady work for Jimmy in a country where the cost of living was much lower than in Ireland, and the weather was warmer, it was an attractive lure for the family. So, they tried to make it work in Australia, but they missed Ireland, and the family returned to a home near their old house. And Rachel was able to return to her school, St. Mary's, and resume her friendships and her sports. Now, Rachel always knew that she was adopted, as did her siblings, and she was curious about her birth mother. So as soon as she turned 18, she asked the Irish Adoption Board to help her get in touch with her birth mother. Now, her biological mom, Teresa Lowe, had married and had four other children. And the family lived right over on the south side of Dublin, so they hadn't gone too far.
Well, apparently not. No. It sounds like things did work out for her birth mother after all. She was married and had other children.
Sure. So she had this emotional reunion with Teresa Lowe and was really fascinated to meet her siblings because there was such a striking family resemblance between her and her siblings, her biological siblings. So that was really something. And Joe O'Reilly, he grew up in nearby Kilbarrock. Hope I'm saying that right.
I have no idea.
Probably not. Kilbarrock?
Sure.
A working class suburb of North Dublin. Now his parents, Joe O'Reilly Sr. and Anne O'Reilly, had moved to the neighborhood from south of the city in Drimbaugh. And I hope I said that correctly. Now Joe's parents married in the late 1960s after they met in a dance hall when they were both in their early 20s. Joe Sr. worked for a Dublin corporation while Anne stayed home with the children. Now they had their first child, Derek, and then they had Joe. And Joe was born in April of 1972, and then he had a sister born after that named Anne Jr.
Well, okay.
Now, when their fourth child, Martina, was born, their joy was tinged with heartbreak, though, because Martina was born blind, and she also had Down syndrome.
Wow.
So that was their fourth child.
Wonder where the blindness came from, because that's not usually a feature of Down syndrome.
I don't know.
Huh.
Must have been war going on.
Must have been.
But Anne O'Reilly was a dedicated mother, and she was really determined to do her best for Martina. And in 1976, when Joe was 4 years old, his uncle, Anne's brother, Christy Lynch, was convicted of murder. So this is interesting. Christy spent years in prison, but his conviction was eventually overturned, and he was released as an innocent man.
Huh.
Yeah. Now, Christy Lynch was convicted of the murder of Vera Cooney at her home in Sandy Mount, Dublin, in 1976. He'd actually confessed to the fatal stabbing of Ms. Cooney. She was a single 51-year-old Dublin Gas employee. And after his conviction, Christy protested that detectives from the murder squad, nicknamed the Heavy Gang, had beaten him and constantly questioned him for 22 hours, basically forcing a confession out of him.
Well, we've heard about that story before. Not his particular one, but...
No,
just,
but it's kind of a
lengthy
topic.
Interrogations and forced confessions. It's something we've hit on before.
Yeah, it's definitely a topic with making a murderer. That was part of it, and many other cases.
Yep.
So the statement in which he admitted the murder was the only piece of evidence that they had in the whole trial. And the Court of Criminal Appeal ordered a retrial on the basis that the statement was inadmissible. But the same statement was allowed to be put to the jury in the retrial, and Christy was found guilty for the second time. But the Supreme Court, in a very rare ruling, set him free and declared him innocent. So my point with this is that it may have formed some of Joe's mother's opinions about the police, because she really backed up Joe through everything and didn't trust the police.
Right. Definitely. Probably. Definitely probably. I would say that probably there was some influence on how her thinking was in terms of viewing the police.
Well, how could it not influence you?
Yeah.
So anyway, as a teenager, Joe attended Greendale Community School. And even though he was the second oldest, he was the leader of the bunch. He had a physically commanding presence from a young age because he was really tall and he towered over the rest of the family. Now, in Joe's late teens, his parents divorced. Joe Sr. moved to England, and Joe had contact with his father over the phone, but he didn't visit him in England until many years later when he brought his girlfriend Rachel over to meet his dad. So some following the case would later speculate on the impact of Joe's father's absence, and if that had factored into Joe's determination to remain a full-time figure in his children's lives, regardless of his marriage.
Yeah, I guess that's a possibility, but... The parents weren't divorced until Joe was in his late teens, right?
Yeah.
So I think there's less likelihood that was a huge influence, just because he was almost grown up.
Well, that's true, but maybe he saw the effect on his younger siblings as well.
Could be. So Rachel was about 17 years old when she first met Joe O'Reilly. After finishing school, she got a part-time job in Arnott's department store. That's where she caught the eye of 19-year-old fellow employee Joe, though they both worked in the same store.
Mm-hmm.
Joe would later tell the media that he noticed Rachel right away because she was so tall, nearly 6 feet, and he was 6'5". So, a good match in terms of height.
Yeah.
Joe pursued Rachel. He overheard her telling a friend about her softball practice, so he turned up there. He asked her to the movies. Rachel liked that Joe was tall and athletic, like her, and she was flattered by his attention. I guess he was being very attentive, showing up at her softball games and asking her out a lot. As their relationship progressed, Rachel and Joe planned for a future together. Rachel even got a second job at a video store in the evenings to earn extra money. So they have some plans. They seemed like a perfect match, with similar backgrounds and aspirations. Couples seem very compatible. Rachel's family has said that Rachel is very much in love with Joe.
Yeah, even towards the end. Now, they really shared this love of sports, and they played on the same softball team, as I mentioned earlier. They also kept exercise equipment in their home and went to the gym pretty often. And Joe proposed to Rachel on top of the Eiffel Tower in 1994. But they waited until they returned to Dublin to buy the engagement ring, which Rachel wanted to pick out herself. So they did marry, but not until 1997, and they had a big traditional Irish wedding. Joe and his brother Derek, who was his best man, wore full mourning attire. Rachel wore an off-the-shoulder ivory gown with a full veil and flowers woven in her hair. She looked gorgeous.
Yeah, we saw those in one of the clips.
Yeah.
She was a good-looking bride.
Yep.
And he was a handsome groom.
It was a nice wedding,
it was.
Seemed like.
I liked the formal attire.
Yeah, it's really nice.
Yeah.
After a two-week honeymoon on safari in Kenya, they returned to their small home in Santry. Now, Joe had left Arnott's and was working in Santry as a team leader at Oracle, a software company. But they were a really popular couple. While Rachel was like the life of the party, kind of outgoing and talkative, Joe was the quieter one, but that seemed to work for them. And they both got along really well with their respective in-laws as well. So it seemed like things are going great.
It seems like
they're a compatible couple. They have a nice wedding. The families get along. So it's really a shame that things have to go so badly later on.
Yeah, they had a pretty good relationship, not just with each other, but with other family members.
Yeah.
Joe and his brother-in-law, Anthony, shared a love of movies. They often went to the cinema together. And Rachel visited Joe's sister, Martina, at the residential center where she lived.
Yeah, she's the one who had Down syndrome and was blind.
And blind.
Yeah.
Right. So when they get married, 97?
Yeah.
So 3 years after they got married in 2000, their first son, Luke, was born. Less than 2 years later, another son, Adam, arrived. So pregnancy apparently was difficult for Rachel. She was hospitalized for several weeks with each pregnancy. In the meantime, Joe's career is going well. In 2002, after the birth of their younger son, Joe was given a management position with Viacom, an outdoor advertising company. This was a very big promotion. His job was to coordinate the company's posters division, which puts ads on the sides of buses and in train stations. He also had to check up on the work of his colleagues and employees. This involved going to stations and bus depots to make sure that posters were properly placed. So he's a boss man.
He is.
Yeah.
But that kind of turns out being part of the problem when he's unfaithful is that he has this excuse to skip out of the house at any hour, it seems like.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So some friends would say that the deterioration in the O'Reilly's marriage began with Joe's promotion. A friend of the couple, Paula Carney, would say that after Joe began his new position, he started going out overnight on supposed night bus inspections in Limerick and Cork. Now, Paula had a friend that also worked at Viacom. When asked why Joe would be doing overnight inspections, the friend simply said he doesn't. So we know there that there was trouble. Now, it was hard to know how many of the warning signs Rachel had noticed. Friends have said that she was very private, and she was very determined to behave as if everything was fine, even when it wasn't. Also, Rachel was really busy. In addition to raising two small boys, she played softball and hockey, she worked one night a week at the solicitor's office, and she also sold Avon and Tupperware, so she's quite a go-getter.
She's got lots of stuff on her plate here.
She does.
I mean, these are two little kids, too.
Right.
Yeah.
And she probably didn't have to do that because Joe had a good job.
Yeah, she wanted to stay busy.
I guess so. According to her dad, she was also a real do-it-yourselfer, working hard to fix up the home. You know, even like putting in new flooring herself and stuff like that.
Wow.
Yeah. But then by 2003, the couple decided to move to a nicer, quieter neighborhood.
They were getting out of the city.
Yeah. And Joe, he claimed to be too busy to look for a new home. So Rachel went house hunting on her own. Her father, Jimmy, was fond of the village of Naul, about 20 miles from the Kalali's house. I'll get it right eventually. So Rachel went and looked at houses there, and it seemed ideal to her. So what do we know about the village of Naul?
Well, we know that it's old.
Okay.
Yeah. It was populated since the Stone Age, or that area was populated since the Stone Age, and people know this based on prehistoric earthworks that were found in the area. So the name Naul comes from an Irish word for cliff, and there's a river running through Naul with cliffs on either side. I think it's the Dublin River. And it's, as you said, it's kind of a suburb of Dublin. It's located between Dublin and the port city of Droda. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like a nice place to be raising a family.
Very quiet, it looked like.
Yeah, there's like 200 people that live there.
The population?
The population.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's smaller than I had imagined.
It's very small.
Yeah.
But again, it's just a short hop into Dublin.
Right, so, which is perfect.
Yeah.
Because she wants a country house to raise the kids. And she found a 3-bedroom bungalow. It needed some work, but that was no problem. She didn't mind that, and her brothers would help her. And it also had a really large yard. So she brought Joe to see it, and they got a good price, and she was thrilled. They bought the house. So then, within weeks of moving in, she asked Joe to buy a barbecue. She threw a big party and met the neighbors. So she's very social. So from the outside, I'd say that Rachel's life seemed happy. But actually, her relationship with Joe was really falling apart. And she didn't confide in her family, maybe out of loyalty to Joe, or maybe just because she didn't want to worry anyone. But she did acknowledge some concerns about her marriage to a couple of her friends. Rachel's close friends had noticed that Joe wasn't around as much as he used to be either. You know, he'd even decided that he and Rachel should join different softball teams, saying that they wouldn't have to pay a babysitter if they played on different nights. So he's really pulling away from her in a major way. And he was often sleeping in the spare room as well. He told people that it was just a midweek thing, so he wouldn't wake Rachel when he worked late. Now, the two also had disagreed about whether to have a third child. Rachel wanted to have a girl to complete their family, but Joe said he was happy with their two sons and he didn't want to have any more children. So in October of 2003, Joe went on a softball trip with friends, even though it took him away for Rachel's birthday, and she was really brokenhearted over this. And she told a girlfriend that she couldn't remember the last time that Joe had even kissed her. So this is a year before her murder.
There's some trouble going on here,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm. But Joe would tell his friends he wasn't getting any at home, even though he was the one that was avoiding the intimacy with his wife. Mm-hmm. So he's kind of a dick.
It does sound like that. I mean,
like a jerk.
He's having an affair or several affairs, but he's having extramarital relations, as they say, and he's telling everybody that it's his wife's fault.
Pretty much, yeah. So he began staying over at his office 2 nights a week. You know, supposedly, claiming that it was more convenient for him to get to his softball practices that way.
Right, and for those overnight inspections, it was easier.
Right, so he didn't have to explain, but we know that he really wasn't working. So he was waking up at 6 a.m., going to the gym before work, and then arriving home late in the evening. And Rachel began to feel like she was raising the boys completely on her own. And rumors of an affair circulated among their friends. But Rachel was pretty quick to dismiss them. According to one of Rachel's friends, Rachel tried to laugh off the rumors. And she would say, why would he have an affair? He isn't even interested in sex. So that's a big red flag.
That's true.
Yeah. So he'd withdrawn from Rachel and the family life, and Rachel even planned date nights, dressing up and hiring babysitters, only to be disappointed when Joe would cancel or not even show up. And in June, Rachel was really distraught when she was anonymously reported to social services for being rough with the children. Now, friends described Rachel as a loving mother who never abused her boys. and Joe was making it clear that he no longer loved Rachel. But she seemed to care for him right up until she died, actually.
So do we know who reported her to the family services people?
It was an anonymous report, but from some emails looked up later on after Rachel was murdered, it seems like it was Joe or his sister, because they were trying to figure out how to get custody from Rachel of the boys.
Well, custody would go to the father, right? Until he gets charged with the crime.
Well, this is before she died. He wanted to get custody while she was alive.
Oh.
So he was trying to make her seem an unfit mother.
I get it. Sorry, I jumped ahead.
That's okay.
So, yeah, I can see that. He's trying to get custody, maybe with her having visitation rights. But he'd be primary custody.
Well, he wanted full custody, yeah.
Yeah.
But she would have primary custody in most cases because she's the mother, right? And he works full time.
Right, but that's why he reported her, so that he could get custody.
Yes, that was the plan.
Yeah.
I don't know what he planned on doing with the kids all day. I guess just keeping them in daycare.
His girlfriend would take care of them.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
Well, before we get into all that, let's just pause for a minute and tell our listeners about HelloFresh, our sponsor.
Let's do that.
It's a meal delivery service, and they have convenient, affordable, really delicious meals that they will deliver to your home, right? And they take less than 30 minutes to make.
Right, about 30 minutes.
Yeah, it's really an awesome service.
It is.
So if you were to go to HelloFresh.com/TCB, you'd get $35 off your first delivery, and that would be a good way to support the brewery.
It would.
Yep.
I just have to tell this story, though.
Okay.
A few days ago when I came home from work, now, I'll preface this by saying I'm the one that does probably 95% of the cooking in the family, just because I enjoy it and it kind of relieves my stress. Very relaxing.
Mm-hmm.
But I came home from work and there's my lovely wife, Jill, chopping up carrots and stuff. And I said to her, Jill, what are you doing? And she says, well, I'm making dinner. And I kind of laughed and said, but you don't cook. And Jill said, but I do now. I got this HelloFresh stuff.
I was excited. Yeah.
And so she's cooking away. And she made this delicious meal of mushroom lo mein. Had carrots in it and stuff. It was great. What a wonderful meal. So then I'm thinking, wow, this is great. This is something that novice cooks can do. Or even experienced cooks that might be short on time. It's a good way to do it.
Yeah.
It's very simple to use. There's very detailed instructions. Everything's measured out in exact quantities, so there's no waste.
I really like that. It's earth-friendly.
Me too. And the ingredients are all the freshest ones. The other thing I think is cool is that they have a full-time registered dietitian who reviews each recipe to ensure that it is a nutritionally balanced recipe.
That's really good. If you're trying to really pay attention to your health, or if you have kids, it would be super nice.
Wouldn't it?
Yeah. Like having your own personal dietitian, almost.
It almost is. No. That's what it reminds me of.
Yeah.
You know the meal you're getting is something that's been vetted and looked on as a good meal. Not just a good tasting meal, but a good healthy meal.
Right.
So.
And it's not automatic. You pick what you want, when you want, and they even have an app for your mobile phone. I would recommend people try it.
People got to try it.
So once again, that's HelloFresh.com/TCB to get $35 off. So let's go back to our Rachel O'Reilly.
Back to Rachel.
Rachel's case. So Rachel's mother, Rose, thought that Rachel remained loyal to Joe. She loved Joe, Rose told a reporter, and she would have looked over anything that made him look bad. But 9 days before Rachel's death, according to Rachel's friend Jackie, Rachel said that she had given Joe an ultimatum. He'd gone off to England and Rachel had spoken to him on the phone. No more late night inspections, she told him, or she would go ahead and get a divorce. But things didn't improve after that. Now, the Sunday before Rachel was murdered, she and Joe had an argument, and Rachel confronted Joe about his affair after he heard her children mention Daddy's friend Nikki, referring to his mistress. So he'd even introduced her to the children.
This is pretty brazen.
It is. But Joe slept in the spare room as usual, and then he left at 5:40 a.m. for the gym, and Rachel woke a couple of hours later for a busy day ahead on the day she died. And it was like any other Monday, but it would only be two more hours after she did this that she would be beaten to death in her own home. Brutally beaten to death, I must say.
Definitely.
So on the morning of October 4th, 2004, she had a long list of things to do, and she got the boys ready for school. She had Avon and Tupperware to deliver. It would be time to pick up Adam at 12:30 p.m. Now, it was her friend Michelle Mulligan's turn to pick up Luke and her own kids from school that day, so she didn't have to worry about that. The two moms had made an arrangement a couple months before. Rachel did the pickup on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and Michelle on Mondays and Fridays. So Rachel dropped her boys at their schools, and around 10 a.m., the local milkman saw her car back outside of the house. He did notice, though, that the curtains were closed, which wasn't normal.
Yeah, see, this little tiny village where everybody knows everybody else's business. the milkman looks at the house and sees the curtains drawn and knows that that's not a normal thing.
Right. So when she hadn't arrived to pick up Adam at 12:45, Helen Moore, who ran the Montessori school where Adam went, was really surprised, and she called Rachel's home number. There was no answer, so she left a message.
Then she tried Rachel's cell phone, but that went to voicemail. After trying both phones a few times, Helen decided to call Joe. By the time she found his number, it was after 1 o'clock in the afternoon. So she reached Joe in his cell. He said he was eating lunch and would make a call. Several minutes later, he called Helen back and said he was on his way to get Adam. I guess he couldn't find anyone else to pick the kid up.
Yeah, I don't know if he called around for that.
So Joe arrived finally at the school at 2:05, flushed but otherwise looked fine, according to Helen. When Joe had gotten off the phone with Helen, he had called his brother-in-law, Anthony Colali. Anthony was still living at home and was helping Jim paint the exterior of the house when his cell phone rang. According to Anthony, Joe sounded agitated. He asked if Rachel was at the family house. Anthony checked with his parents and two brothers and told Joe that Rachel hadn't been to the house.
Kind of strange that he would think she'd be at her family's house when the kids are in school and going to be picked up and stuff.
It would.
That's really strange.
I think he's trying to establish some kind of alibi or something.
I think so. So Anthony tried calling Rachel several times, but it kept going to voicemail. And then Rose left a message, and she asked Rachel to contact her. Now, she'd been in the kitchen making lunch when Joe called Anthony, and she immediately felt like something was wrong when she heard, because it wasn't like Rachel not to pick up her kids on time. So Rose decided to drive straight to Rachel's home. And she was relieved at first because she saw Rachel's car there, but then the closed curtains were odd to her as well. Just wasn't something that they normally did, I guess.
Apparently not.
People are noticing it.
At least a couple people commenting on it.
Yeah. So when Rose went inside, the kitchen water faucet was running. There were some cabinet doors open and some stuff scattered on the floor. Now she was going through the house, so everything looked normal in the kids' room. But when she looked in the master bedroom, she got a real shock because she saw Rachel lying on the floor in there. It was a really disturbing sight. It would have been for anyone, but for Rachel's mother, who loved her so much, it was just horrifying.
Right. Because she wasn't just lying there. She was lying there in a pool of blood.
Yeah, brutally murdered.
Her face was smashed up almost beyond recognition.
Yeah.
And, as I said, a lot of blood.
A lot of blood. Now, her lifeless body was splayed out on the bedroom floor, and her blonde hair was completely matted to the floor with blood. Rose said the blood looked like jam because it was drying and congealed all through her hair. And she could tell right away that Rachel was dead. She was rubbing Rachel's arms, which were really mottled and cold like marble. So what Rose did is she went to call for help, but she was just pushing random buttons because she was just in such a state. And some guy answered. She didn't know who she'd called, but she said to the guy, "I think my daughter's dead. Can you send an ambulance?" Because she was just freaked out. So she hadn't really called emergency services, even though she'd called for help.
So she ended up talking to some random guy?
I think so, yeah.
Did he call emergency services?
We don't know who he was or anything. I don't know. But Sarah Harmon did show up. So Sarah was friends with Rachel. And then Rachel's dad had called her. So Rachel's dad was worried when Rose went to check on Rachel. and he'd called the neighbor, Sarah, and told her to go over and check what was going on. So she showed up, and Sarah saw Rachel's body in the bedroom, and she called emergency services. Now, the emergency services people, they told her to check Rachel for a pulse, but of course there was none. And then others began to arrive at the house. Michelle Mulligan, who had picked up Luke from school, she arrived, and then Joe pulled in behind her with their younger son, Adam, in his car. So Rose is just crazed with grief, and she goes running to meet them in the driveway because she doesn't want the boys to see Rachel like that. And Rose looked at Joe, and she said he smiled at her. So that kind of gave her the creeps.
That would.
Now, let's say if he hadn't done the murder and he was innocent, it wouldn't be that strange that he smiled because he doesn't really know what's wrong.
Right.
But if we think that he did it, then that's pretty creepy.
That's beyond creepy.
So according to Rose, Joe went in and he just put two fingers on Rachel's neck. And he said to Rachel, "Jesus, Rachel, what did you do?" And that was really odd to Rose that he said that. But she thought, you know, maybe he's in shock too.
Sure. He's not thinking correctly.
Right. So another friend, Jackie Connor of Rachel's, arrived at the house. Now, she was a nurse who'd been sleeping after a night shift when Joe called that afternoon. And it was Jackie's birthday. And Joe said he called to see if Rachel was with her. So this was strange, Jackie thought. Why would Rachel not pick up Adam? So Jackie gave up on trying to get any more sleep, and she also drove to Rachel's house. So on the way, she looked for any cars off the road, because she was afraid that maybe Rachel had had an accident. So, wow, I just can't believe how many people care about her.
Yeah.
I don't think that many people would check on me. You know, they'd probably wait till they smelled the body or something. But there's all these people checking up on her, so she was well-loved. It's amazing.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is. I mean, it's almost like half the town or half the village was showing up there.
Mm-hmm. Really, a lot of people.
So Jackie arrived at the O'Reilly house around 2:30, thereabouts, so that Rose, Sarah, and Joe were there, quite upset, and it was obvious that something was seriously wrong. Joe told Jackie to go to the bedroom to see if she could do anything, because she's a nurse after all.
Right, right.
Rachel's condition in the scene of the crime was gruesome and gave her a jolt. I think that's an understatement. Great deal of blood and a large gash on the right side of Rachel's head. Her face was not recognizable. There was no pulse. She was cold and stiff. So, sounds like a bad thing.
Nothing could be done.
Room was very dark with the curtains closed.
Yeah, so which we know was unusual.
Unusual. Meanwhile, Jimmy Colalli had been calling his wife, and when he finally reached her, she gave him the shocking news. Rachel's brother Paul called for an ambulance, and then he drove his father to the O'Reilly home. Joe had called for an ambulance as well, telling the operator that there were CDs all over the place and blood on the walls. So who cares about the CDs all over the place?
Well, that makes me think he was just trying to make it seem like a burglary by saying that.
Right.
Trying to support the burglary theory.
That's going to come up.
Yeah. But the operator told Joe to stay out of the bedroom because obviously it was a crime scene. It sounded like that to her.
Yes.
And then,
it did.
Yeah. And then the paramedics arrived, and they immediately found the scene suspicious, partially because there was such a drastic amount of trauma to Rachel. It just seemed like overkill. Rachel's other brothers, Declan and Anthony, arrived, and eventually they took their parents home. Because the house was a crime scene, there was nothing they could do there. Rachel was dead, and Joe took his two sons to his mother's house. To me, that's a little odd, because you would think the family would all want to be together.
You would.
Don't you think they'd all go to the Colalli house together?
Yes.
I said that last name right, didn't I?
Colalli.
Oh, shit.
You're almost there.
Colalli. Okay. I thought I had it. But I think it's kind of odd that he took his kids and went to his mother's. Because they were supposed to all be close. In such a tragedy, wouldn't you all want to be together, I would think.
One would think.
But right after Rachel's murder, it was generally believed that she'd been a victim of a burglary gone wrong. Because things were thrown about. And there were also some stories of a criminal gang from North Dublin being responsible. The house was quite isolated. You know, maybe they were robbing the house and Rachel surprised them when she returned from taking the boys to school that morning. That was a possibility.
Yeah, but nothing of real value was missing.
No.
And there was a fair amount of money lying around.
That's true. The crime scene team didn't find any unknown blood, hair, or other DNA either. So the house had no evidence that a stranger, you know, a robber, somebody like that, had been in it. It only had the family's DNA in it.
Right. Crime scene team's headquarters in Dublin was a half hour away from the O'Reilly house. When they were there looking at evidence, the only fingerprints in the house were from the family. The only blood found that wasn't Rachel's was Thomas Lowe's.
Now, he was her biological brother.
He's her biological brother. He explained how his blood got on the washing machine in the laundry room. He had cut himself while building a deck in the yard, dripped some blood onto the floor and washing machine while getting bandages from the first aid kit in the laundry room. So there's a definite lack of any evidence. So the police had to consider that the absence of any other fingerprints made it likely that Rachel had been killed by someone close to her.
Absolutely.
Yeah. To determine an approximate time of death, a series of body temperatures were taken by the state pathologist. On the night before her funeral, her parents had family and friends to their house for a wake memorial celebration of life.
Yeah. It was decided at that gathering that those who wanted to should write a farewell letter to Rachel. So this is a significant piece because of Joe's letter that he writes.
Right. And so, we'll find out how we recognize or how we came to hear what he had written.
Right. So what you could do is you could write a farewell letter saying things to Rachel that you would have liked to say, and then they would place it in her coffin and she'd be buried with it. And most people at the gathering actually did it, including Joe. Then at the funeral, Joe spoke of how Rachel had brought happiness to him and his sons. He also brought up how athletic she'd been and how she had accomplished her goals of getting married, having children, a house in the country, and many friends. So he ended that part by saying, "Mission accomplished, Rachel. Well done. See you on the other side. We all thank you. Bye for now." So that part to me is really telling because it seems like he's trying to convince himself that she'd done what she really needed to do and it's okay that he got rid of her.
Yes.
Yeah. Did you take it that way?
I did.
Okay. And then he decided to say a few words to the person responsible. And this is telling, too, because he said that Rachel had forgiven her killer, and he hoped that she would give him the strength to forgive as well. So it's kind of strange. I know a lot of people can be forgiving, but this is a little weird to me.
It is.
To bring that up.
But when you look at things, it's almost like he's fingering himself.
Yeah, almost. And his reaction to her brutal murder seemed really strange. You know, he was still quite sociable, laughing and joking, and he wasn't grieving like her family was. I mean, her family was devastated. And he just didn't seem to be there with them in that. And then after the funeral, there was a reception at the Regency Hotel in Dublin. And many who attended would say that Joe had some inappropriate things that he said and said some really disturbing things to some people. So I'll give you a couple examples, okay?
Yes, please.
Fiona Slevin, friend of Rachel's, said that she had a conversation with Joe that was very upsetting. In reference to the murder weapon, Joe had told Fiona, "I don't know why they're searching in the fields. It's in the water." And then when she gave him a funny look, he added, "Well, that's what I would do if I was a policeman. That's where I'd be looking." And then Tara Kennedy, another friend of Rachel's, was really taken aback when Joe said, "It's ironic. Here we are in the church at 10 a.m., and Rachel had been killed at 10:05 a.m. And here we are at 2 p.m. at the reception when the body was found at 2:10 p.m. So I muddled that a little bit, but you get the picture.
Well, yeah, I mean, he's trying to draw some parallels. It's just poorly done.
Yeah.
Poorly spoken.
I don't see the point of it.
None.
Unless it's just nervous chatter, but it's just kind of inappropriate.
Yeah, I guess it could have been nervous chatter, although my picture of him is kind of a glib talker.
Oh, okay.
At least from what I've read and seen.
Well, the police had thrown out the burglary theory by the time of the funeral. The scene looked staged. 860 euros were left behind in a container in the utility room, and there was over 400 euros left in Rachel's purse. And all that had been taken was this video camera bag and a satchel with a jewelry box in it. And both of those things were found less than half a mile away from the house.
Yeah.
And also these items look like they'd just been neatly placed in the ditch.
Yeah, they're quite visible.
Yeah, they didn't look like they were tossed aside.
No.
They were like sat down neatly.
Like they're supposed to be found.
Yeah, they were visible from the road.
To lend credence to the burglar theory.
Right, right. But whoever killed Rachel would have been covered in blood, so that's another point. And there'd been no trail of blood, and no one had spotted anyone fleeing the area. So it seemed that Rachel's murderer was very calculating, probably showering and taking the towels and clothes away with them from the house.
Right.
Because there was no bloody person running through the fields.
No bloody person seen leaving the house.
No.
And no blood really in the house other than Rachel's blood, but there wasn't a trail of blood anywhere.
Mm-mm.
So this was a cold calculating move.
Yes, that's what they thought. And a statement from the receptionist at Joe's office was what really raised the serious suspicions about Joe. So Michelle Slattery told investigators that Joe had arrived back at the office at about noon and that his face was puffy and bloated and red like he'd been crying. Now, in his interviews with police, Joe said that he and Rachel had had kind of a rocky patch, but they were okay at the time of her murder. And he denied cheating on her. He denied cheating on her two times, and then on his third interview, he admitted to cheating, but he really minimized it. That it wasn't really a romantic relationship.
It's nothing serious.
Right. And on the day of the murder, Joe told investigators he'd left the house at 5:40 a.m., meeting his co-worker, Derek Quarney, at the gym, and after that he went to the office and left again to do a bus inspection at the Broadstone Depot in central Dublin. Now that was between 9:30 and 11:30 a.m., he said. And Quirney confirmed Joe's story, and that gave him an alibi.
So he's got an alibi.
Yeah. So that's a difficult thing for police.
Yes. Tough to be in two places at once, right?
Right. And then about a week later, Joe and Rachel's parents were interviewed for a TV show. Now, the three of them sat together on a sofa, close enough so that Rose and Joe's knees touched. And they took turns speaking and asked for anyone with information to come forward. So they seemed like they were on the same team. But then a week after that, Joe and Rose were interviewed on the Late Late Show. This was just October 22nd, so a little over 2 weeks since the murder. And if you watch this interview, you can see the distance and the tension between them.
So something's happened in the past week between the first and second interview.
Yeah, I think that Rose has changed her mind about this.
Right.
She's getting suspicious. So it was very tense and not at all like the earlier interview.
Not at all. This time, in this interview, Joe and Rose sat in two armchairs facing the host and the audience. Rose was sitting stiffly, never looked at Joe. When Joe was talking, Rose stared into the audience, where her husband Jimmy, daughter Anne, and Sarah Harmon were sitting. So she's not even looking at him.
No, she can't.
Joe leaned forward in his chair, seemingly interested in the host's questions, cracked a couple of jokes. That's not a good move.
No.
Smiling, he seemed to be enjoying the attention. He spoke about the day of Rachel's murder, how he went to the bedroom and saw the bloody, violent scene. Joe said he had checked for a pulse to do some CPR, and when the paramedics arrived, he knew that she couldn't be saved. But he added, "I knew if they had brought her back, she's going to suffer massive brain damage, and she'd never be the same again."
Yeah, but nobody really thinks that way in a crisis. You just want to save your loved one no matter what.
Yeah, you don't even have that thought cross your mind. It's
strange.
No.
Well, weird thing was that after this interview, a lot of people from the community just called in and said, "Take a look at him. We think he did it." Yeah. So he didn't come across well in this interview at all.
He must not have represented himself very well in that interview.
No, people didn't like him. And the host brought up statistics that say that 8 to 9 out of 10 murder victims know their attacker. Then he asked Joe if he thought Rachel knew her killer, and Joe said yes, and he added, everyone, including myself, is a suspect until this is solved. So that was kind of strange. Although, I guess you'd acknowledge that. I don't know.
Well, I mean, I guess you have to, in a sense.
It might not be that strange.
The proverbial elephant in the room. Everybody who does any crime shows and stuff knows that a spouse or significant other is one of the big suspects.
Absolutely. The first one.
So he's got to bring that up first.
Right, right. Now, he was staying at his mother's house and keeping his sons with him. And then after the crime scene had been processed, he was given the keys back to their house in Naul. But he wasn't shy about talking to the media at all. He went through the details of the day Rachel died over and over, offering up some theories as well. For example, on October 21st, reporter Jenny Friel went to the house to interview him. Now, she's the one who ended up authoring a book on the crime that we read, titled The Suspect.
Yes.
And I'd highly recommend this book. It was a fascinating look at this really planned out and brutal case.
It was a good, well-written story.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I would recommend it because she actually was there and talked to Joe. So she went to the house and interviewed him. And she would write that he seemed like an ordinary, polite guy. And at first she really thought that he was innocent. And to the outside world, he seemed normal, affable. But the facts would show that he had spent some time planning Rachel's murder, carried it out with extreme brutality, and then faced those who loved her, pretending to be the grieving widower. So Joe went over the day of Rachel's death with Friel. Describing gruesome details in a calm, matter-of-fact way, he told her that Rachel's head had been stuck to the carpet with a large amount of blood from her head wounds. Then he showed her their wedding album, and she said that was the only part of the interview when he showed some emotion. His eyes welled up with tears, and he said it had been a long time since he'd looked at those photos. So maybe he was really feeling bad looking back at when he really cared about her.
Possibly.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if his eyes teared up, it's possible. Because even the worst monsters have some feelings, don't they?
Possibly.
I think they do, usually.
Joe also took Friel to the bedroom to show her the crime scene. Carpet where Rachel had been found was cut and taken as evidence. He pointed out the blood spatter on the walls. He was strangely calm and clinical about the crime. So he's shown her where it happened and everything, discussing the brutality of the crime. It's just weird stuff.
Yeah, and he offered it up. She didn't ask to see it. He offered up, do you want me to show you? And she was a little taken aback by that.
Yeah, I would be. So even though Joe knew that his affair with Nikki, her name is Nikki Pelly, could be viewed as a motive for his wife's murder, he was seen in public with her. Nikki was at his son Adam's birthday party.
Wow.
Double wow. Nikki was an attractive blonde in her 30s. Joe had met her in 2002 while both of them were working at Viacom. The romantic relationship, or sexual relationship, is believed to have started in mid-2004. In January of 2004, the two were at a pub with co-workers and they exchanged emails. And they began to send jokes and stories to each other by email.
So at that point, they know they're flirting with something they shouldn't be.
We're flirting.
Yeah.
Now, she's unmarried.
Yes.
So she's okay.
She's okay.
But he's a married guy. And presumably, Nikki knew that he was married.
Right, but he had had affairs before, so he wasn't a good husband even before that, right? Because over a year before she was murdered, he was already spending nights away.
Yes.
Yeah.
And not with Nikki.
No, he had some other people.
Yeah.
Other women. So soon they were meeting for lunch and movie dates, Nikki and Joe. And by April, they'd begun having sex, and Joe would stay over at Nikki's place on Tuesday nights. And then, as the affair became more serious, they're planning a life together, and Joe would spend his Saturday nights with Nikki as well. And that's when he introduced his sons to Nikki. He actually took the three of them to the zoo and some other family-type places a couple of Saturdays. So he's getting ready to start this whole new family. He wants to keep his kids and just kind of replace Rachel, which isn't how divorce works.
No.
No.
So the plan A was to gain custody of the kids and divorce his wife and be with Nikki.
Right. He thought if he could prove her unfit.
Right. But that didn't work.
No.
So he had to go to plan B, which was to get rid of his wife.
And Nikki's a little suspicious, too. I think she probably at least knew something about it after the fact.
Really?
Yeah. On November 16th, Nikki and Derek Queerney, the alibi guy, they were arrested for questioning. So they were both held under Section 30 of the Offenses Against the State Act, which allowed them to be held for up to 72 hours. And it was believed that Queerney and Nikki were withholding information. And then Joe was arrested, too, and he was questioned for hours. But all three were released without being charged. And that was a big disappointment to Rachel's family, obviously.
For sure.
Because they were relieved, thinking that her murderer had been caught and they were going to get some closure, I guess.
Well, he is going to get caught.
Well, yeah, but it was taking a long time.
Yeah, this is several months after the crime.
Yes. Well, a couple months. But it goes on and on.
Does go on and on. National Bureau of Criminal Investigation and local police held daily conferences on Rachel's case. Over 700 witness statements had been taken. And they finally got a break when they examined Joe's cell phone records.
This was a big part,
This is a big one, because this is going to lead to finding out that his alibi wasn't a real alibi.
Correct.
But I jump ahead. So an analysis of calls and texts made and received on Joe's phone that day showed that the phone had been in the vicinity of the house at the time of Rachel's murder. There was also closed-circuit TV footage of a car resembling Joe's, which was close to his home at the time. This is something that's a little suspicious because Joe's car wasn't a common model on the Irish roads. It's a Ford Maria, I guess, M-A-R-E-A. It's a large estate car, so it stood out. Investigators took weeks tracking down as many other owners of that model as they could find to eliminate them. Meanwhile, Joe's family continued to support him. So investigators continued the investigation but couldn't gather enough evidence to charge Joe. Though they're getting closer.
They are. They're working on it.
So now they have cell phone records that indicate he was in the vicinity. And they have CCTV images of a car resembling his that was in the vicinity. So looks like they're getting closer.
Yeah, they're putting together a pretty good circumstantial case here.
Right.
But it wasn't until March 2006 that the Minister of Justice was convinced to give permission for exhuming Rachel's remains. And that was in order to find the letter that Joe had written to Rachel and placed in her grave, or her coffin. The family thought that Joe's letter to Rachel might reveal his involvement, that he might have said something in it.
Sure. I can see you're writing this letter that's going into the coffin to be buried. It's never going to be looked at by anybody.
Right, right.
You can write anything you want.
Relieve his conscience that way.
Yeah.
But he was really getting angry at the family because the family was thinking he had done it and trying to get justice. So he was taking out his anger with Rachel's family by talking, you know, pretty much just talking trash about him. He was lying about their relationships with her. He told several people that Rachel wasn't really close to her mother and that they fought a lot. He also claimed that Rose and Jimmy hadn't made any efforts to see their grandchildren, which was completely untrue.
All false.
Yeah. Now, stories about Rachel's case were occasionally in the papers and the TV news programs. Behind the scenes, though, investigators were working and gathering evidence because they definitely had focused in on Joe. And then Joe and Nikki were finally arrested again that March. And Nikki wasn't a suspect, but she was questioned about her phone calls and texts with Joe. And then they were both released again with no charges.
This was Joe's first arrest, right? He wasn't arrested. Oh, he was arrested back when the others were arrested the first time?
Yeah, but it seems different in Ireland, and I don't know exactly, but it seems like you get arrested for questioning, and then you're released.
Okay.
So arrested doesn't mean charged.
Obviously.
Yeah. So it was that October 2006 that Joe was finally charged with Rachel's murder. And then his trial didn't begin until June 25th, 2007. So these are some slow wheels of justice.
3 years later.
Mm-hmm. The Callally family.
Callally.
Shit. The Callally family attended the trial, as did Rachel's biological family, the Lowes. Joe's mother, Anne, sat alone, three rows behind them. Now, the letter written by Joe and found in Rachel's coffin was read. And the most incriminating part, I think, was the sentence here. And I quote it. "This is the hardest letter I have had to write for reasons only we know. Rachel, forgive me."
Wow.
That's quite incriminating.
That sounds incriminating, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. It does. Now, her friends Jackie and Michelle testified that Rachel was unhappy in her marriage and that Joe had been staying out overnight at least two or three times a week, and when he was home, he slept in the spare room. Now, another friend, Helen Reddy, not the singer.
Not that Helen Reddy.
No. Told jurors about the conversation she had with Joe on the night of the murder. Joe had said that there was no way that Rachel had been sexually assaulted. But how could he know that?
And how did that topic come up anyway?
I don't know. They were talking about the crime and he said that. I'm not sure why.
Yeah.
But it seems strange that he was convinced she wasn't, because he really couldn't know unless he did it.
Right.
Now, Michelle Slattery from Viacom testified about how Joe had arrived in the office with the puffy face and the red eyes as if he had been crying. And detectives testified that there were 30 different areas of blood spatter in the house. Also, they observed that the washing machine had been set at a 40-degree wash cycle, and the clothes inside were clean and damp. So, you know, it could be that he washed the bloody clothes.
Could be. And 40 degrees is a pretty hot wash.
Right.
Right.
But, you know, they always say cold water is better for blood stains.
Right. But 100...
But if you want to...
104 degrees...
If you want to get rid of evidence, I guess hot water is better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You'll get rid of the DNA.
Is that unusually hot for a wash? I have no idea.
Good question.
Okay. I don't know what...
No, I mean, most people will have their hot water heater set at 120 degrees.
For the hottest water you
can get. For the hottest water, so you don't get scalded.
Okay.
But when you run it through the pipes into the washing machine, it probably does cool down a little. So that's a hot wash.
Okay.
So there was a forensic pathologist, Dr. Diane Daly, a forensic scientist, was able to conclude that Rachel had been repeatedly beaten. And she said it was likely that the killer had been crouched or kneeling over her during the attack, and that her head had been moved afterwards. She told jurors that she believed Rachel was violently beaten for a sustained length of time while lying on the floor.
Oh, gosh, that's horrible.
So, and she was beaten, they surmised, with a set of barbells or something, right? Some really heavy...
With a weight, yeah. It was missing.
Yeah.
So they thought that was probably the murder weapon.
So that's going to do a lot of damage.
I can't imagine that. Ugh, why would you need to hit someone so much with that?
Well.
That's just brutal.
My guess is because he wanted to make sure she was dead.
Yeah, but I think there's some rage behind it as well. I think he really hated her.
Definitely some rage. But here she is being beaten. You don't die instantaneously with blunt trauma to the head.
Well, would she have been unconscious, though?
Or she might have been gasping or breathing or sputtering blood. So he kept hitting her.
It's awful.
It was ugly. It was also revealed during the trial that it was Joe who had anonymously reported Rachel to social services for being snappy with the children.
Oh, so I guess they did find out it was him.
Right.
I'd forgotten about that.
When Rachel was questioned and determined to be a fit mother, Joe sent emails to his sister stating that he would never get custody of his boys in a divorce. He'd also admitted early in the course of the investigation that he'd had his cell phone with him all that day. So that's important.
That is important.
Because it doesn't work if he left the phone someplace and it's pinging off of a tower near his home. But he had it with him, so he was there.
Right. So just a little bit about these emails with his sister. They were horrible.
They were.
They were calling her the C word. Just downright nasty.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't understand why the sister hated her so much.
Because her big brother hated her.
Because she'd been convinced by her. But they just seem like nasty people. Why would you be that nasty to anyone? If you're not in love, you'd get out. Why would you be so nasty about it?
Well, I think it's a little telling that the only one of his family that attended the trial was his mother.
Yeah.
No one else.
Right. So the mobile records were crucial evidence. Joe's records showed that he'd been in contact with Nikki Pelly, though he claimed the relationship had ended. Now, records on October 4th, 2004, showed how Nikki's landline was used to call Joe's cell at 5:45 a.m., and then there was another call made from Joe's phone to Nikki's landline at 7:35 a.m. And then a call was made from Nikki's cell to Joe's cell at 8:12 a.m. Joe's cell called Rachel's cell at 1:20, 1:26, and 1:47 p.m. And his cell also rang the home phone at 1:21 and 1:50. Now, during that day, there had been 18 contacts between Nikki and Joe, just in that one day. That's what makes me think maybe she knew something was up.
Yeah.
And then she kind of lied for him, too, right? So
she did.
So I think she knew something was up. If she wasn't actually in on it, she was
aware.
Yeah. So footage from the reception area at Viacom showed Joe leaving the building at 8:07 a.m., and then at 8:55 a.m., a car believed to be Joe's was seen heading to the OReilly home. So at 9:03 a.m., Rachel O'Reilly's Renault was seen passing the quarry where the camera was, and she was going away from the house. And then at 9:40, it's seen driving back towards the house. And then 18 minutes after that, the estate car that matches Joe's is driving back past the quarry away from the house.
Uh-huh.
So, it seems as if he went there while she was out, waited for her, come back.
And attacked her.
Attacked her quite quickly, cleaned up, and went back to work.
Yep.
Now, a text sent from Joe's cell to Rachel's cell at 10:07 a.m. showed that Joe was near the house and in the area where the estate car was seen on CCTV footage. So that was very damning for him.
Certainly was.
Because that was what they thought the time of death was, around 10 a.m. So a map of locations with cell phone activity was displayed by the prosecution as the timeline of events was reviewed in the closing arguments, and it was very convincing. The jury was out for about a day and a half before finding Joe guilty of murder, and his life sentence means that he's expected to serve at least 12 years in prison. Now, if Joe had been acquitted, he would have made 434,000 euro on life insurance policies.
That's a pretty good amount.
Now, interestingly enough, but
felons can't collect on life insurance policy?
No. Well, not especially if they murdered the person.
Right.
Now, interestingly enough, Nikki still visits Joe, and it was reported in a Dublin paper that the two still plan to get married.
Nothing as strong as a love of each other.
True love.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else to say about it?
No, not really. I think it was a thorough investigation. When the only other thing I'd say was that when they talked to his associate again after getting the cell phone records, and he had to admit that, well, maybe my times were a little off. And when they were together at the Broadmoor station.
A couple hours off, actually, yeah.
So, he was maybe not definitely lying for him, but he was favorable to Joe.
Sure.
Initially.
Yeah, right.
So.
Okay.
But I think that they got the person who committed the crime.
Yes, they did. But I think it's a really sad case. And the brutality of it really shows a lot of rage.
Oh, it does.
Yeah. All right, so that concludes today's episode. If you're interested, please stick around for our feedback segment after the music. Welcome to our feedback segment. I guess that transition wasn't too bad for our first try. So the first one I'm going to bring up is about an unfit mother, and this was on YouTube by Liberty Lovecat. So Liberty Lovecat said, "This thought just came to mind. I'm in the middle of this podcast, but I just remembered hearing that San Antonio specifically is known for shady adoptions. How true this is, not quite sure. I hate to think this is trafficking or worse, but Gabriel is quite recognizable. And goes on a little bit.
Okay.
So what do you think about that?
Well, I think we discussed that in the podcast about the hotel that they were staying at for a short time. It is a hotel that's notorious for adoptions, both above ground and underground.
Yeah, so that makes it possible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where we were trying to keep some hope that maybe he was alive and had been adopted out.
Sure. But I kind of think if that happened and she was being put in jail, she would have given more information to police about what happened. Instead of just saying it was these two people in the park.
True.
She would have confessed about the illegal adoption, if that was what she did, I think.
Well, she ended up walking anyway, after serving her time.
She did.
So maybe her attorney told her this was the best course.
Well, I don't think so. Because she could have gotten out sooner if she just told them.
I suppose.
Makes me think that she did kill him, unfortunately.
Yeah, but I think it's still a good thought that based on where they stayed in San Antonio, it could have been that he had got adopted out.
It's a possibility.
Yep.
Okay. What have you got?
I got one from Kate by email talking about Justice Revisited. This is the guy who'd been in jail for murdering two people and got out.
Right.
And was living with a son and was molesting the son's granddaughters, I think. Wasn't daughters, was it? Family members.
Young girls.
Young girls.
Yeah. The whole point of the story was that his wife had framed him for murder and he'd gotten out. And then after he was out, he was found guilty of molestation.
Right. There was, although, a lot of discussion about whether she had actually framed him or not. Just she had tried to frame him.
Right.
Or
right.
How much that had worked. Anyway.
Yeah.
Kate says in her email, "So I have a theory about why she framed him, if she framed him. I think she knew he was a pedophile, and that's why she was divorcing him. And the reason she framed him was because she wanted him off the streets but couldn't prove the pedophilia. What do you think?"
I think it's a possibility.
I do, too.
Good thinking, Kate. Yeah.
I like how she's come up with that. Because my initial thing was, well, she should have just reported him to the police about being a pedophile. But if nothing could be proven, and she needed him out of the house, off the streets, so he couldn't be practicing his pedophilia, that would work. A good thought.
Well, and also remember that his ex-wife, was it his ex-wife? Or no, they were still married. It was his ex-wife when he got arrested, because that was later.
Right.
Right. Well, she worked at the police station.
Yeah.
So she had some ins there. So I wouldn't be surprised if maybe someone helped her.
That's true. I mean, there was all this fingerprint stuff and things that may or may not have been true. Anyway, this is an interesting thought.
I think it's a good theory. I would consider that.
Yeah. And then one final note on Bill McCumber. This is from Redone JS53.
Mm-hmm. On YouTube, right?
It's on YouTube. And it's just an update that Bill McCumber died October 10th, 2016, at the age of 81. And that's all we know. But didn't he have cancer or something?
Maybe. He was a chain smoker.
Yeah.
He didn't look very good. What else have you got?
No, he didn't. That's it on Justice Revisited.
Okay.
I have another one from Heather. It's an email on fetal abduction. And Heather writes, "Hi, Jill. Great episode tonight. Definitely one of the most fascinating and disturbing crimes to examine. I think one possibility of why some women commit fetal abductions is that our society gives pregnant women a great deal of positive attention. Think of how tabloids are obsessed with baby bumps on accomplished celebrities and other public figures. In the case of the woman in Chicago who murdered her pregnant childhood friend and drowned the children, I wonder if the murderer was jealous of all the attention her friend got for being a mother. Maybe the murderer herself was infertile." Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very true statement.
I do, too.
So if you're pregnant, you get more attention.
It's true.
And if you have a baby and you're a caring mother, you get plenty of attention.
Right. And I think it's a trap that some women fall into. is just getting their attention that way instead of by their accomplishments. Like she said, celebrities get attention that way. So it's a way to get attention.
It is. So good thought.
Yeah. So we have a few people who sent feedback in on For the Love of Crystal. So that was an interesting podcast that we did back in July about a missing woman, Crystal Rogers. So Jennifer Miles Hurst wrote, I'm from Bardstown, Kentucky, and I'm so glad you discussed the disappearance of Crystal Rogers. In November, her father, Tommy Ballard, was shot and killed while he was hunting. The incident is being investigated as a possible murder. Most of the residents in Bardstown are afraid. The police are not releasing any information, which leads to speculation amongst the community. Is this another murder by Brooks Hauk? Is this a random shooting, a serial killer? So interesting. Thanks, Jennifer. That's interesting to hear.
Well, I mean, it sure is. And this is a small town. Bardstown's got a population of like 14,000 or something like that. And there's been several murders over like a 3-year period.
Yeah, that's what we were looking at. There seems to be, there was the policeman in May 2013, Jason Ellis, who was murdered, and that's unsolved.
And no, that was prior to the disappearance of Crystal, so he wasn't involved in the investigation of her disappearance.
No, Crystal disappeared in July of 2015, because we did the podcast on the one-year anniversary of her disappearance.
Right.
And so Jason, the policeman, was killed in May 2013, and then Kathy Netherland and her daughter Samantha Netherland were killed in their home in April of 2014. And then Crystal went missing in 2015, and then Crystal's father, Tommy Ballard, was shot and killed in 2016, just this past November.
Right. Now, we still don't know whether that was a hunting accident or murder.
It's, right.
It's still being investigated.
It is.
But there seems to be a fair number of deaths by unnatural means.
It's really strange, and it might just be purely coincidence.
It could be.
But I just find it interesting.
I mean, you think, wow, there's some conspiracy theory going on here. But then again, you look at the size of the town. There, Bardstown's pretty much the same size as the town we live in.
That's small.
And can you remember the last time a murder was committed here?
No. So it's very strange.
So here Bardstown is with 4, maybe 5 murders, and we're looking at 0 with a comparably sized town.
Right. Well, also interesting, which we mentioned in the other podcast, was in 1979, Sherry Ballard Barnes, Crystal's aunt, disappeared and was found murdered in 1984. Her husband had hired someone to kill her.
Right.
So this family's been through a lot.
No kidding.
And we don't have any idea about Tommy, but we do know that he was looking for Crystal for quite a while.
Yeah.
With the other family members. Okay, I have another one from YouTube. And this is by Irrational Geographic. Crystal was having an affair, and one wonders if Brooks found out and killed her. On the other hand, his brother Nick has acted very strangely and did fail a lie detector test. Plus, his police car boot and a blanket in the boot tested positive for blood. And in the words of one of the detectives, after it was sprayed with luminol, the whole boot glowed blue like a Smurf.
Okay.
This is what they're saying, that she had an affair, and maybe that's why he killed her.
Well, I think the suspicion is that Brooks killed her.
And then maybe his brother helped
him. And his brother helped him dispose of the body. I think we looked at it that way in the podcast back last July.
Yeah, because they used their grandmother's car, and then the car hasn't been seen again, right?
Right.
Well, I got another comment on YouTube from Rob Perry. You're confusing some of the facts. Brooks was interviewed by the county sheriffs. They are leading the investigation of the case, not the Bardstown PD. So he worked for the PD, and the sheriffs were the people that were investigating.
Well, Brooks's brother worked for the PD.
Nick
did.
Okay.
Brooks wasn't a cop.
So it wasn't his department that was investigating, it was the sheriff's department.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that might be because they investigate all murders that way. It's not something that the local sheriff's department will do. They need more expertise, so they call in the bigger guns from the police, the state police.
Sure.
So
But I had misspoke that in the podcast, so I wanted to correct.
Okay.
And then also on YouTube, Michael Nally says, it's understandable that the investigators know more than is released, but the state telling Nick that samples from the trunk of his cruiser were sent to the crime lab raised my eyebrows. That has not been followed up on publicly, as far as I know. So I think what the police did was lie to him to get him to say something. Is that what we're talking about?
I think that's what we were intimating.
But according to this other comment, something did test positive for blood.
Right.
In Nick's car.
The whole trunk lit
up. Well, this is an interesting case that I really want to keep following, because something's going on. I don't know if these things are connected, but I would really be curious if Crystal and Tommy Ballard are at least connected, because it's very strange that she went missing and then her father, just a little over a year later, is shot dead.
It could be. I mean, I suppose the way you'd look at that was that he had found something out that was going to be damaging to the murderer. So Tommy Ballard had to be murdered, too.
It's possible.
Right?
Could be threatening the whole family if anybody talks.
Could be.
We don't know.
No.
And we don't know that Brooks Hauck did it, either.
No, we don't.
We don't really know. So it's just speculation, but I enjoy reading people's feedback. I have gotten a few people writing to me that are from the area, so it's interesting. I appreciate it.
Yes, good thoughts.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's going to wrap up our feedback section today.
Okay.
We'll keep it short today. So there are many ways to support this podcast. You can join Team Tie Grabber, or you can make a purchase in the brewery shop, and those are at tiegrabber.com. Also, you can follow us on Twitter at TieGrabberPods and on Instagram and on Facebook, tiegrabber.com/Facebook. We also are on Patreon if you just look up True Crime Brewery. Also, we still appreciate those 5-star reviews, so if you feel like we're worth 5 stars, we'd appreciate you going ahead and giving us a review. And also, I hope that everyone will keep the feedback coming, because we hope to improve upon this segment and make it a little more involved as time goes on.
So just one final thing. Remember, HelloFresh.com/TCB. $35 off.
And we'll see you at the quiet end of the bar.
Look for us.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Well, I got another comment on YouTube from Rob Perry. You're confusing some of the facts. Brooks was interviewed by the county sheriffs. They are leading the investigation of the case, not the Bardston PD. So he worked for the PD, and the sheriffs were the people that were investigating.
Well, Brooks's brother worked for the PD.
Nick.
Nick did.
Okay.
Brooks wasn't a cop.
So it wasn't his department that was investigating. It was the sheriff's department.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that might be because they investigate all murders that way. It's not something that the local sheriff's department will do. They need more expertise, so they call in the bigger guns from the police, the state police.
Sure.
So.
But I had misspoke that in the podcast, so I wanted to correct.
Okay.
And then also on YouTube, Michael Nally says, it's understandable that the investigators know more than is released, but the state telling Nick that samples from the trunk of his cruiser were sent to the crime lab raised my eyebrows. That has not been followed up on publicly, as far as I know. So I think what the police did was lie to him to get him to say something. Is that what we're talking about?
I think that's what we were intimating.
But according to this other comment, something did test positive for blood.
Right.
In Nick's car.
The whole trunk lit up.
Well, this is an interesting case that I really want to keep following, because something's going on. I don't know if these things are connected, but I would really be curious if Crystal and Tommy Ballard are at least connected. Because it's very strange that she went missing and then her father, just a little over a year later, is shot dead.
It could be. I mean, I suppose the way you'd look at that was that he had found something out that was going to be damaging to the murderer. So Tommy Ballard had to be murdered, too.
It's possible.
Right?
Could be threatening the whole family if anybody talks.
Could be.
We don't know.
No.
And we don't know that Brooks Hauck did it either.
No, we don't.
We don't really know. So it's just speculation, but I enjoy reading people's feedback, I have gotten a few people writing to me that are from the area, so that's interesting. I appreciate it.
Yes, good thoughts.
Yeah. Okay, well, that's going to wrap up our feedback section today.
Okay.
We'll keep it short today. So there are many ways to support this podcast. You can join Team Tie Grabber, or you can make a purchase in the brewery shop, and those are at tiegrabber.com. Also, you can follow us on Twitter at tiegrabberpods and on Instagram and on Facebook, tiegrabber.com/Facebook. We also are on Patreon if you just look up True Crime Brewery. Also, we still appreciate those 5-star reviews, so if you feel like we're worth 5 stars, we'd appreciate you going ahead and giving us a review. And also, there were also some stories of a criminal gang from North Dublin being responsible. The house was quite isolated. You know, maybe they were robbing the house and Rachel surprised them when she returned from taking the boys to school that morning. That was a possibility.
Yeah, but nothing of real value was missing.
No.
And there was a fair amount of money lying around.
That's true. The crime scene team didn't find any unknown blood, hair, or other DNA either. So the house had no evidence that a stranger, you know, a robber, somebody like that had been in it. It only had the family's DNA in it.
Right. Crime scene team's headquarters in Dublin was a half hour away from the O'Reilly house. When they were there looking at evidence, the only fingerprints in the house were from the family. The only blood found that wasn't Rachel's was Thomas Lowe's.
Now, he was her biological brother.
He's her biological brother. He explained how his blood got on the washing machine in the laundry room. He had cut himself while building a deck in the yard, dripped some blood onto the floor and washing machine while getting bandages from the first aid kit in the laundry room. So there's a definite lack of any evidence. So the police had to consider that the absence of any other fingerprints made it likely that Rachel had been killed by someone close to her.
Absolutely.
Yeah. To determine an approximate time of death, a series of body temperatures were taken by the state pathologist. On the night before her funeral, her parents had family and friends to their house for a wake memorial celebration of life.
Yeah. It was decided at that gathering that those who wanted to should write a farewell letter to Rachel. So this is a significant piece because of Joe's letter that he writes.
Right. And so, we'll find out how we recognize or how we came to hear what he had written.
Right. So what you could do is you could write a farewell letter saying things to Rachel that you would have liked to say, and then they would place it in her coffin and she'd be buried with it. And most people at the gathering actually did it, including Joe. Then at the funeral, Joe spoke of how Rachel had brought happiness to him and his sons. He also brought up how athletic she'd been and how she had accomplished her goals of getting married, having children, a house in the country, and many friends. So he ended that part by saying, "Mission accomplished, Rachel. Well done. See you on the other side. We all thank you. Bye for now." So that part to me is really telling because it seems like he's trying to convince himself that she'd done what she really needed to do and it's okay that he got rid of her.
Yes.
Yeah. Did you take it that way?
I did.
Okay. And then he decided to say a few words to the person responsible. And this is telling, too.
Town's pretty much the same size as the town we live in.
That's small.
And can you remember the last time a murder was committed here?
No. So it's very strange.
So here Bardstown is with 4, maybe 5 murders, and we're looking at 0. With a comparably sized town.
Right. Well, also interesting, which we mentioned in the other podcast, was in 1979, Sherry Ballard Barnes, Crystal's aunt, disappeared and was found murdered in 1984. Her husband had hired someone to kill her.
Right.
So this family's been through a lot.
No kidding.
And we don't have any idea about Tommy, but we do know that he was looking for Crystal for quite a while.
Yeah.
With the other family members. Okay, I have another one from YouTube, and this is by Irrational Geographic. Crystal was having an affair, and one wonders if Brooks found out and killed her. On the other hand, his brother Nick has acted very strangely and did fail a lie detector test. Plus, his police car boot and a blanket in the boot tested positive for blood. And in the words of one of the detectives, after it was sprayed with luminol, the whole boot glowed blue like a smurf.
Okay.
This is what they're saying, that she had an affair, and maybe that's why he killed her.
Well, I think the suspicion is that Brooks killed her.
And then maybe his brother helped him.
And his brother helped him dispose of the body. I think we looked at it that way in the podcast back last July.
Yeah, because they used their grandmother's car, and then the car hasn't been seen again, right?
Right.
Well, I got another comment on YouTube from Rob Perry. You're confusing some of the facts. Brooks was interviewed by the county sheriffs. They are leading the investigation of the case, not the Bardstown PD. So he worked for the PD, and the sheriffs were the people that were investigating.
Well, Brooks's brother worked for the PD.
Nick
did.
Okay.
Brooks wasn't a cop.
So it wasn't his department that was investigating. It was the sheriff's department.
Yeah.
Okay.
But that might be because they investigate all murders that way. It's not something that the local sheriff's department will do. They need more expertise, so they call in the bigger guns from the police, the state police.
Sure.
So.
But I had misspoke that in the podcast, so I wanted to correct it.
Okay.
And then also on YouTube, Michael Nally says, it's understandable that the investigators know more than is released, but the state telling Nick that samples from the trunk of his cruiser were sent to the crime lab raised my eyebrows. That has not been followed up on publicly, as far as I know. So I think what the police did was lie to him to get him to say something. Is that what we're talking about?
I think that's what we were intimating.
But according to this other comment, something did to the zoo and some other family-type places a couple of Saturdays. So he's getting ready to start this whole new family. He wants to keep his kids and just kind of replace Rachel, which right. isn't how divorce works.
No.
No.
So the plan A was to gain custody of the kids and divorce his wife and be with Nikki.
Right. He thought if he could prove her unfit.
Right. But that didn't work.
No.
So he had to go to plan B. Which is to get rid of his wife.
And Nikki's a little suspicious, too. I think she probably at least knew something about it after the fact.
Really?
Yeah. On November 16th, Nikki and Derek Queerney, the alibi guy, they were arrested for questioning. So they were both held under Section 30 of the Offenses Against the State Act, which allowed them to be held for up to 72 hours. And it was believed that Queerney and Nikki were withholding information. And then Joe was arrested, too, and he was questioned for hours. But all three were released without being charged. And that was a big disappointment to Rachel's family, obviously.
For sure.
Because they were relieved, thinking that her murderer had been caught and they were going to get some closure, I guess.
Well, he is going to get caught.
Well, yeah, but it was taking a long time.
Yeah, this is several months after the crime.
Yes. Well, a couple months. But it goes on and on.
Does go on and on. National Bureau of Criminal Investigation and local police held daily conferences on Rachel's case. Over 700 witness statements had been taken. They finally got a break when they examined Joe's cell phone records.
This was a big part,
This is a big one because this is going to lead to finding out that his alibi wasn't a real alibi.
Correct.
But I jump ahead. So an analysis of calls and texts made and received on Joe's phone that day showed that the phone had been in the vicinity of the house at the time of Rachel's murder. There was also closed-circuit TV footage of a car resembling Joe's, which was close to his home at the time. This is something that's a little suspicious because Joe's car wasn't a common model on the Irish roads. It's a Ford Maria, I guess, M-A-R-E-A. It's a large estate car, so it stood out. Investigators took weeks tracking down as many other owners of that model as they could find to eliminate them. Meanwhile, Joe's family continued to support him. So investigators continued the investigation but couldn't gather enough evidence to charge Joe, though they're getting closer.
They are. They're working on it.
So now they have cell phone records that indicate he was in the vicinity. And they have CCTV images of a car resembling him.
Anonymously reported to social services for being rough with the children. Now, friends described Rachel as a loving mother who never abused her boys. And Joe was making it clear that he no longer loved Rachel. But she seemed to care for him right up until she died, actually.
So do we know who reported her to the family services people?
It was an anonymous report, but from some emails looked up later on after Rachel was murdered, it seems like it was Joe or his sister, because they were trying to figure out how to get custody from Rachel of the boys.
Well, custody would go to the father, right? Until he gets charged with the crime.
Well, this is before she died. He wanted to get custody while she was alive.
Oh.
So he was trying to make her seem an unfit mother.
I get it. Sorry, I jumped ahead.
That's okay.
So, yeah, I can see that. He's trying to get custody, maybe with her having visitation rights. But he'd be primary custody.
Well, he wanted full custody, yeah. But she would have primary custody in most cases because she's the mother, right? And he works full time.
Right, but that's why he reported her, so that he could get custody.
Yes, that was the plan.
Yeah.
I don't know what he planned on doing with the kids all day. I guess just keeping them in daycare.
His girlfriend would take care of them.
Oh, that's right.
Yes.
Well, before we get into all that, let's just pause for a minute and tell our listeners about HelloFresh, our sponsor.
Let's do that.
It's a meal delivery service, and they have convenient, affordable, really delicious meals that they will deliver to your home, right? And they take less than 30 minutes to make.
Right, about 30 minutes.
Yeah, it's really an awesome service.
It is.
So if you were to go to HelloFresh.com/TCB, you'd get $35 off your first delivery, and that would be a good way to support the brewery.
It would.
Yep.
I just have to tell this story, though.
Okay.
A few days ago when I came home from work, now, I'll preface this by saying I'm the one that does probably 95% of the cooking in the family, just because I enjoy it and it kind of relieves my stress. Very relaxing.
Mm-hmm.
But I came home from work and there's my lovely wife, Jill, chopping up carrots and stuff. And I said to her, Jill, what are you doing? And she says, well, I'm making dinner. And I kind of laughed and said, but you don't cook. And Jill said, but I do now. I got this HelloFresh stuff.
I was excited. Yeah.
And so she's cooking away. And she made this delicious meal of mushroom lo mein. Had carrots in it and stuff. It was great. What a wonderful meal. So then I'm thinking, wow, this is great. This is something that novice cooks can do. Or even experienced cooks. Bitterness comes from roasted barley and a generous dose of hops. Although the roasted character is more noticeable. That's for sure. I don't consider this form of stout a very hoppy stout. On to the Guinness itself. It's a black beer with a thick tan head, roasted malt aroma, mostly coffee, a little sweet chocolate taste, and it's on the lighter side, even though you look at it and it's a pitch black beer and you think, oh, this is going to be some heavy damn beer, but it's not. It's pretty light, easily drinkable.
I always did think it was heavy.
But you'd be surprised.
I guess so.
We'll give it a try sometime.
Okay. Let's open it up.
Got it. Okay, Jilly, let's take these beers and our glasses down to the quiet end. And if you notice, it is really quiet tonight.
Well, yes.
Oh, I think that's because we've had like 30 inches of snow in the last few days. So everybody's busy digging out.
Yeah, or staying in their homes.
Yeah, who wants to go out on a night like this? Of course, it finally did stop snowing.
It did.
More to come, too. Anyway, let's start.
Okay. So, Rachel O'Reilly. She was born in October 1973 to a 17-year-old Dublin girl. Her birth name was Teresa Green. Now, her mother made the decision to give her baby for adoption to another family, because she was young, unmarried, and she was unable to support her. So it was a really selfless decision.
It sounds like a well-made decision, too.
Yeah, 17, that's young.
17, no money, not much education.
Yeah, it'd be a rough life.
It would be. So I would say she did the right thing.
Yeah, seems like it. And they were a nice family now. Rose and Jim Kalali?
Kalali.
Kalali. They were delighted to add baby Rachel to their family. They'd already adopted two boys, Declan and Paul, and they would actually go on to adopt two more children after Rachel, Anthony and Anne.
Five adopted kids.
Yep.
Now those are special people too, aren't they, that family?
Yeah, I really think so. Now Jim was working really hard to establish his plumbing contractor business while Rose cared for the children in their home in Glasshaven Park. The family were church regulars, and they were popular in the area. Jimmy was an excellent cyclist who would be seen on his bicycle all over the Dublin countryside. Now, when Rachel went to school, she was really encouraged by her father to participate in sports. And she was athletic. She played basketball, hockey, softball. She did gymnastics, and she was a swimmer.
Yeah, I think basketball was her big sport because she was close to 6 feet tall.
Yeah, very tall. Showering and taking the towels and clothes away with them from the house.
Right.
Because there was no bloody person running through the fields.
No bloody person seen leaving the house.
No.
And no blood really in the house other than Rachel's blood, but there wasn't a trail of blood anywhere.
Mm-mm.
So this was a cold calculating move.
Yes, that's what they thought. And a statement from the receptionist at Joe's office was what really raised the serious suspicions about Joe. So Michelle Slattery told investigators that Joe had arrived back at the office at about noon and that his face was puffy and bloated and red like he'd been crying. Now, in his interviews with police, Joe said that he and Rachel had had kind of a rocky patch, but they were okay at the time of her murder. And he denied cheating on her. He denied cheating on her two times, and then on his third interview, he admitted to cheating, but he really minimized it, that it wasn't really a romantic relationship.
It's nothing serious.
Right. And on the day of the murder, Joe told investigators he'd left the house at 5:40 a.m., meeting his co-worker, Derek Quarney, at the gym, and after that, he went to the office and left again to do a bus inspection at the Broadstone Depot in central Dublin. Now, that was between 9:30 and 11:30 a.m., he said. And Quirney confirmed Joe's story, and that gave him an alibi.
So he's got an alibi.
Yeah. So that's a difficult thing for police.
Yes. Tough to be in two places at once, right?
Right. And then about a week later, Joe and Rachel's parents were interviewed for a TV show. Now, the three of them sat together on a sofa, close enough so that Rose and Joe's knees touched. And they took turns speaking and asked for anyone with information to come forward. So they seemed like they were on the same team. But then a week after that, Joe and Rose were interviewed on the Late Late Show. This was just October 22nd, so a little over 2 weeks since the murder. And if you watch this interview, you can see the distance and the tension between them.
So something's happened in the past week between the first and second interview.
Yeah, I think that Rose has changed her mind about this.
Right.
She's getting suspicious. So it was very tense and not at all like the earlier interview.
Not at all. This time, in this interview, Joe and Rose sat in two armchairs facing the host and the audience. Rose was sitting stiffly, never looked at Joe. When Joe was talking, Rose stared into the audience, where her husband Jimmy, daughter Anne, and Sarah Harmon were sitting. So she's not even looking at him.
No, she can't.
Joe leaned forward in his chair, seemingly interested in
his friend Nikki, referring to his mistress. So he'd even introduced her to the children.
This is pretty brazen.
It is. But Joe slept in the spare room as usual, and then he left at 5:40 a.m. for the gym. And Rachel woke a couple of hours later for a busy day ahead on the day she died. And it was like any other Monday, but it would only be two more hours after she did this that she would be beaten to death in her own home. Brutally beaten to death, I must say.
Definitely.
So on the morning of October 4th, 2004, she had a long list of things to do, and she got the boys ready for school. She had Avon and Tupperware to deliver. It would be time to pick up Adam at 12:30 p.m. Now, it was her friend Michelle Mulligan's turn to pick up Luke and her own kids from school that day, so she didn't have to worry about that. The two moms had made an arrangement a couple months before. Rachel did the pickup on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and Michelle on Mondays and Fridays. So Rachel dropped her boys at their schools, and around 10 a.m., the local milkman saw her car back outside of the house. He did notice, though, that the curtains were closed, which wasn't normal.
Yeah, see, this little tiny village where everybody knows everybody else's business. The milkman looks at the house and sees the curtains drawn and knows that that's not a normal thing.
Right. So when she hadn't arrived to pick up Adam at 12:45, Helen Moore, who ran the Montessori school where Adam went, was really surprised, and she called Rachel's home number. There was no answer, so she left a message.
Then she tried Rachel's cell phone, but that went to voicemail. After trying both phones a few times, Helen decided to call Joe. By the time she found his number, it was after 1 o'clock in the afternoon. So she reached Joe in his cell. He said he was eating lunch and would make a call. Several minutes later, he called Helen back and said he was on his way to get Adam. I guess he couldn't find anyone else to pick the kid up.
Yeah, I don't know if he called around for that.
So Joe arrived finally at the school at 2:05, flushed but otherwise looked fine, according to Helen. When Joe had gotten off the phone with Helen, he had called his brother-in-law, Anthony Colali. Anthony was still living at home and was helping Jim paint the exterior of the house when his cell phone rang. According to Anthony, Joe sounded agitated. He asked if Rachel was at the family house. Anthony checked with his parents and two brothers and told Joe that Rachel hadn't been to the house.
Kind of strange that he would think she'd be at her family's house when the kids are in school and going to be picked up and stuff.
It would, but
it's really strange.
I think he's trying to establish some kind of alibi or something.
I think so. So Anthony tried calling Rachel several times, but it kept going to voicemail. And then Rose left a message, and she asked Rachel to contact her. He also claimed that Rose and Jimmy hadn't made any efforts to see their grandchildren, which was completely untrue.
All false.
Yeah. Now, stories about Rachel's case were occasionally in the papers and the TV news programs. Behind the scenes, though, investigators were working and gathering evidence because they definitely had focused in on Joe. And then Joe and Nikki were finally arrested again that March. And Nikki wasn't a suspect, but she was questioned about her phone calls and texts with Joe. And then they were both released again with no charges.
This was Joe's first arrest, right? He wasn't
second.
Arrested. Oh, he was arrested back when the others were arrested the first time?
Yeah, but it seems different in Ireland, and I don't know exactly, but it seems like you get arrested for questioning, and then you're released.
Okay.
So arrested doesn't mean charged.
Obviously.
Yeah. So it was that October 2006 that Joe was finally charged with Rachel's murder, and then his trial didn't begin until June 25th, 2007. So these are some slow wheels of justice.
3 years later.
Mm-hmm. The Colali family.
Colali.
Shit. The Colali family attended the trial, as did Rachel's biological family, the Lowes. Joe's mother, Anne, sat alone, three rows behind them. Now, the letter written by Joe and found in Rachel's coffin was read. And the most incriminating part, I think, was the sentence here. And I quote it. "This is the hardest letter I have had to write for reasons only we know. Rachel, forgive me."
Well,
that's quite incriminating.
That sounds incriminating, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. It does. Now, her friends Jackie and Michelle testified that Rachel was unhappy in her marriage and that Joe had been staying out overnight at least two or three times a week, and when he was home, he slept in the spare room. Now, another friend, Helen Reddy, not the singer.
Not that Helen Reddy.
No. Told jurors about the conversation she had with Joe on the night of the murder. Joe had said that there was no way that Rachel had been sexually assaulted. But how could he know that?
And how did that topic come up anyway?
I don't know. They were talking about the crime and he said that. I'm not sure why.
Yeah.
But it seemed strange that he was convinced she wasn't. Because he really couldn't know.
He couldn't, unless he did it. Right.
Now, Michelle Slattery from Viacom testified about how Joe had arrived in the office with the puffy face and the red eyes as if he had been crying. And detectives testified that there were 30 different areas of blood spatter in the house. Also, they observed that the washing machine had been set at a 40-degree wash cycle, and the clothes inside were clean and damp. So, you know, it could be that he washed the bloody clothes.
Could be.
And they were going to get some closure, I guess.
Well, he is going to get caught.
Well, yeah, but it was taking a long time.
Yeah, this is several months after the crime.
Yes. Well, a couple months, but it goes on and on.
Does go on and on. National Bureau of Criminal Investigation and local police held daily conferences on Rachel's case. Over 700 witness statements had been taken. They finally got a break when they examined Joe's cell phone records.
This was a big part,
This is a big one, because this is going to lead to finding out that his alibi wasn't a real alibi.
Correct.
But I jump ahead. So an analysis of calls and texts made and received on Joe's phone that day showed that the phone had been in the vicinity of the house at the time of Rachel's murder. There was also closed-circuit TV footage of a car resembling Joe's, which was close to his home at the time. This is something that's a little suspicious because Joe's car wasn't a common model on the Irish roads. It's a Ford Maria, I guess, M-A-R-E-A. It's a large estate car, so it stood out. Investigators took weeks tracking down as many other owners of that model as they could find to eliminate them. Meanwhile, Joe's family continued to support him. So investigators continued the investigation but couldn't gather enough evidence to charge Joe. Though they're getting closer.
They are. They're working on it.
So now they have cell phone records that indicate he was in the vicinity. And they have CCTV images of a car resembling his that was in the vicinity. So looks like they're getting closer.
Yeah, they're putting together a pretty good circumstantial case here.
Right.
But it wasn't until March 2006 that the Minister of Justice was convinced to give permission for exhuming Rachel's remains. And that was in order to find the letter that Joe had written to Rachel and placed in her grave, or her coffin. The family thought that Joe's letter to Rachel might reveal his involvement, that he might have said something in it.
Sure. I can see you're writing this letter that's going into the coffin to be buried. It's never going to be looked at by anybody.
Right, right.
You can write anything you want.
Relieve his conscience that way.
Yeah.
But he was really getting angry at the family because the family was thinking he had done it and trying to get justice. So he was taking out his anger with Rachel's family by talking, you know, pretty much just talking trash about him. He was lying about their relationships with her. He told several people that Rachel wasn't really close to her mother and that they fought a lot. He also claimed that Rose and Jimmy hadn't made any efforts to see their grandchildren, which was completely untrue.
All false.
Yeah. Now, stories about Rachel, what do you think about that?
Well, I think we discussed that in the podcast about the hotel that they were staying at for a short time. It is a hotel that's notorious for adoptions, both above ground and underground.
Yeah, so that makes it possible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's where we were trying to keep some hope that maybe he was alive and had been adopted out.
Sure. But I kind of think if that happened and she was being put in jail, she would have given more information to police about what happened. Instead of just saying it was these two people in the park.
True.
She would have confessed about the illegal adoption, if that was what she did, I think.
Well, she ended up walking anyway after serving her time.
She did.
So maybe her attorney told her this was the best course.
Well, I don't think so. Because she could have gotten out sooner if she just told them.
I suppose.
Makes me think that she did kill him, unfortunately.
Yeah, but I think it's still a good thought that based on where they stayed in San Antonio, it could have been that he had got adopted out.
It's a possibility.
Yep.
Okay. What have you got?
I got one from Kate by email talking about Justice Revisited. This is the guy who had been in jail for murdering two people and got out.
Right.
And was living with a son and was molesting the son's granddaughters, I think. Wasn't daughters, was it? Family members.
Young girls.
Young girls.
Yeah. The whole point of the story was that his wife had framed him for murder and he'd gotten out. And then after he was out, he was found guilty of molestation.
Right. There was, although a lot of discussion about whether she had actually framed him or not. Just she had tried to frame him.
Right.
Or
right.
How much that had worked. Anyway.
Yeah.
Kate says in her email. So I have a theory about why she framed him, if she framed him. I think she knew he was a pedophile, and that's why she was divorcing him. And the reason she framed him was because she wanted him off the streets but couldn't prove the pedophilia. What do you think?
I think it's a possibility.
I do, too.
Good thinking, Kate. Yeah.
I like how she's come up with that. Because my initial thing was, well, she should have just reported him to the police about being a pedophile. But if nothing could be proven, and she needed him out of the house, off the streets, so he couldn't be practicing his pedophilia, that would work. So it's a good thought.
Well, and also remember that his ex-wife, was it his ex-wife? Or no, they were still married. It was his ex-wife when he got arrested, because that was later.
Right.
Right. Well, she worked at the police station.
Yeah.
So she had some ins there. So I wouldn't be surprised if maybe someone helped her.
That's true. I mean, there was all those fingerprints, changed emails. And they began to send jokes and stories to each other by email.
So at that point, they know they're flirting with something they shouldn't be.
We're flirting.
Yeah.
Now, she's unmarried.
Yes.
So she's okay.
She's okay.
But he's a married guy. And presumably Nikki knew that he was married.
Right, but he had had affairs before, so he wasn't a good husband even before that, right? Because over a year before she was murdered, he was already spending nights away.
Yes.
Yeah.
And not with Nikki.
No, he had some other people.
Yeah.
Other women. So soon they were meeting for lunch and movie dates, Nikki and Joe. And by April, they'd begun having sex, and Joe would stay over at Nikki's place on Tuesday nights. And then, as the affair became more serious, they're planning a life together, and Joe would spend his Saturday nights with Nikki as well. And that's when he introduced his sons to Nikki. He actually took the three of them to the zoo and some other family-type places a couple of Saturdays. So he's getting ready to start this whole new family. He wants to keep his kids and just kind of replace Rachel, which right. isn't how divorce works.
No.
No.
So the plan A was to gain custody of the kids and divorce his wife and be with Nikki.
Right. He thought if he could prove her unfit.
Right. But that didn't work.
No.
So he had to go to plan B, which was to get rid of his wife.
And Nikki's a little suspicious, too. I think she probably at least knew something about it after the fact.
Really?
Yeah. On November 16th, Nikki and Derek Queerney, the alibi guy, they were arrested for questioning. So they were both held under Section 30 of the Offenses Against the State Act, which allowed them to be held for up to 72 hours. And it was believed that Queerney and Nikki were withholding information. And then Joe was arrested, too, and he was questioned for hours. But all three were released without being charged. And that was a big disappointment to Rachel's family, obviously.
For sure.
Because they were relieved, thinking that her murderer had been caught and they were going to get some closure, I guess.
Well, he is going to get caught.
Well, yeah, but it was taking a long time.
Yeah, this is several months after the crime.
Yes. Well, a couple months. But it goes on and on.
Does go on and on. National Bureau of Criminal Investigation and local police held daily conferences on Rachel's case. Over 700 witness statements had been taken. They finally got a break when they examined Joe's cell phone records.
This was a big part,
This is a big one, because this is going to lead to finding out that his alibi wasn't a real alibi.
Correct.
But I jump ahead. So an analysis of calls and texts made and received on Joe's phone that day was born. Less than 2 years later, another son, Adam, arrived. So pregnancy apparently was difficult for Rachel. She was hospitalized for several weeks with each pregnancy. In the meantime, Joe's career is going well. In 2002, after the birth of their younger son, Joe was given a management position with Viacom, an outdoor advertising company. This was a very big promotion. His job was to coordinate the company's posters division, which puts ads on the sides of buses and in train stations. He also had to check up on the work of his colleagues and employees. This involved going to stations and bus depots to make sure that posters were properly placed. So he's a boss man.
He is.
Yeah.
But that kind of turns out being part of the problem when he's unfaithful is that he has this excuse to skip out of the house at any hour, it seems like.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So some friends would say that the deterioration in the O'Reilly's marriage began with Joe's promotion. A friend of the couple, Paula Carney, would say that after Joe began his new position, he started going out overnight on supposed night bus inspections in Limerick and Cork. Now, Paula had a friend that also worked at Viacom. When asked why Joe would be doing overnight inspections, the friend simply said, he doesn't. So we know there that there was trouble. Now, it was hard to know how many of the warning signs Rachel had noticed. Friends have said that she was very private, and she was very determined to behave as if everything was fine, even when it wasn't. Also, Rachel was really busy. In addition to raising two small boys, she played softball and hockey, she worked one night a week at the solicitor's office, and she also sold Avon and Tupperware. So she's quite a go-getter.
She's got lots of stuff on her plate here.
She does.
I mean, these are two little kids, too.
Right.
Yeah.
And she probably didn't have to do that because Joe had a good job.
Yeah, she wanted to stay busy.
I guess so. According to her dad, she was also a real do-it-yourselfer, working hard to fix up the home. You know, even like putting in new flooring herself and stuff like that.
Wow.
Yeah. But then by 2003, the couple decided to move to a nicer, quieter neighborhood.
They're getting out of the city.
Yeah. And Joe, he claimed to be too busy to look for a new home. So Rachel went house hunting on her own. Her father, Jimmy, was fond of the village of Naul, about 20 miles from the Kalali's house. I'll get it right eventually. So Rachel went and looked at houses there, and it seemed ideal to her. So what do we know about the village of Naul?
Well, we know that it's old.
Okay. Yeah.
It was populated since the Stone Age, or that area was populated since the Stone Age, and people know this based on prehistoric not thinking correctly.
Right. So another friend, Jackie Connor of Rachel's, arrived at the house. Now, she was a nurse who'd been sleeping after a night shift when Joe called that afternoon. And it was Jackie's birthday. And Joe said he called to see if Rachel was with her. So this was strange, Jackie thought. Why would Rachel not pick up Adam? So Jackie gave up on trying to get any more sleep, and she also drove to Rachel's house. So on the way, she looked for any cars off the road because she was afraid that maybe Rachel had had an accident. So, wow. I just can't believe how many people care about her.
Yeah.
I don't think that many people would check on me. You know, they'd probably wait till they smelled the body or something. But there's all these people checking up on her, so she was well-loved. It's amazing.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is. I mean, it's almost like half the town or half the village was showing up there.
Mm-hmm. Really, a lot of people.
So Jackie arrived at the O'Reilly house around 2:30, thereabouts. So that Rose, Sarah, and Joe were there, quite upset, and it was obvious that something was seriously wrong. Joe told Jackie to go to the bedroom to see if she could do anything, because she's a nurse after all.
Right.
Rachel's condition in the scene of the crime was gruesome and gave her a jolt. I think that's an understatement. Great deal of blood and a large gash on the right side of Rachel's head. Her face was not recognizable. There was no pulse. She was cold and stiff. So, sounds like a bad thing.
Nothing could be done.
Room was very dark with the curtains closed.
Yeah, so which we know was unusual.
Unusual. Meanwhile, Jimmy Kalali had been calling his wife, and when he finally reached her, she gave him the shocking news. Rachel's brother Paul called for an ambulance, and then he drove his father to the O'Reilly home. Joe had called for an ambulance as well, telling the operator that there were CDs all over the place and blood on the walls. So who cares about the CDs all over the place?
Well, that makes me think he was just trying to make it seem like a burglary by saying that.
Right.
Trying to support the burglary theory.
That's going to come up.
Yeah. But the operator told Joe to stay out of the bedroom because obviously it was a crime scene. It sounded like that to her.
Yes.
And then
it did.
Yeah. And then the paramedics arrived and they immediately found the scene suspicious. Partially because there was such a drastic amount of trauma to Rachel. It just seemed like overkill. Rachel's other brothers, Declan and Anthony, arrived, and eventually they took their parents home. Because the house was a crime scene, there was nothing they could do there. Rachel was dead, and Joe took his two sons to his mother's house. To me, that's a little odd, because you would think the family would all want to be together.
You would.
Don't you think they'd all go to the Kalili house together?
Yes.
I said that last name right.
To conclude that Rachel had been repeatedly beaten, and she said it was likely that the killer had been crouched or kneeling over her during the attack, and that her head had been moved afterwards. She told jurors that she believed Rachel was violently beaten for a sustained length of time while lying on the floor.
Oh, gosh, that's horrible.
So when she was beaten, they surmised with a set of barbells or something, right? Some really heavy...
With a weight, yeah. It blunt. Was missing.
Yeah.
So they thought that was probably the murder weapon.
So that's going to do a lot of damage.
I can't imagine that... Ugh, why would you need to hit someone so much with that?
Well...
That's just brutal.
My guess is because he wanted to make sure she was dead.
Yeah, but okay. I think there's some rage behind it as well. I think he really hated her.
Definitely some rage, but here she is being beaten. You don't die instantaneously with blunt trauma to the head.
Well, would she have been unconscious, though?
Or she might have been gasping or breathing or sputtering blood. So he kept hitting her.
It's awful.
It was ugly. It was also revealed during the trial that it was Joe who had anonymously reported Rachel to social services for being snappy with the children.
Oh, so I guess they did find out it was him.
Right.
I'd forgotten about that.
When Rachel was questioned and determined to be a fit mother, Joe sent emails to his sister stating that he would never get custody of his boys in a divorce. He'd also admitted early in the course of the investigation that he'd had his cell phone with him all that day. So that's important.
That is important.
Because it doesn't work if he left the phone someplace and it's pinging off of a tower near his home. But he had it with him, so he was there.
Right. So just a little bit about these emails with his sister. They were horrible.
They were.
They were calling her the C word. Just downright nasty.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't understand why the sister hated her so much.
Because her big brother hated her.
Because she'd been convinced by her, but they just seem like nasty people. Why would you be that nasty to anyone? If you're not in love, you'd get out. Why would you be so nasty about it?
Well, I think it's a little telling that the only one of his family that attended the trial was his mother.
Yeah.
No one else.
Right. So the mobile records were crucial evidence. Joe's records showed that he'd been in contact with Nikki Pelly, though he claimed the relationship had ended. Now, records on October 4th, 2004, showed how Nikki's landline was used to call Joe's cell at 5:45 a.m., and then there was another call made from Joe's phone to Nikki's landline at 7:35 a.m. And then a call was made from Nikki's cell to Joe's cell at 8:12 a.m.
Ordered into the police about being a pedophile, but if nothing could be proven, and she needed him out of the house off the streets so he couldn't be practicing his pedophilia, that would work. So it's a good thought.
Well, and also remember that his ex-wife, was it his ex-wife? Or no, they were still married. It was his ex-wife when he got arrested, because that was later.
Right.
Right. Well, she worked at the police station.
Yeah.
So she had some ins there, so I wouldn't be surprised if maybe someone helped her.
That's true. I mean, there's all this fingerprint stuff and things that may or may not have been true. Anyway, this is an interesting thought.
I think it's a good theory. I would consider that.
Yeah. And then one final note on Bill McCumber. This is from Redone JS53.
Mm-hmm. On YouTube, right?
It's on YouTube. And it's just an update that Bill McCumber died October 10th, 2016. At the age of 81, and that's all we know. But didn't he have cancer or something?
Maybe. He was a chain smoker.
Yeah.
He didn't look very good. What else have you got?
No, he didn't. That's it on Justice Revisited.
Okay.
I have another one from Heather. It's an email on fetal abduction. And Heather writes, "Hi, Jill. Great episode tonight. Definitely one of the most fascinating and disturbing crimes to examine. I think one possibility of why some women commit fetal abductions is that our society gives pregnant women a great deal of positive attention. Think of how tabloids are obsessed with baby bumps on accomplished celebrities and other public figures. In the case of the woman in Chicago who murdered her pregnant childhood friend and drowned the children, I wonder if the murderer was jealous of all the attention her friend got for being a mother. Maybe the murderer, herself was infertile. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very true statement.
I do too.
So if you're pregnant, you get more attention.
It's true.
And if you have a baby and you're a caring mother, you get plenty of attention.
Right. And I think it's a trap that some women fall into, is just getting their attention that way instead of by their accomplishments. Like she said, celebrities get attention that way. So it's a way to get attention.
It is. So good thought.
Yep. So we have a few people who sent feedback in on For the Love of Crystal. So that was an interesting podcast that we did back in July about a missing woman, Crystal Rogers. So Jennifer Miles Hurst wrote, I'm from Bardstown, Kentucky, and I'm so glad you discussed the disappearance of Crystal Rogers. In November, her father, Tommy Ballard, was shot and killed while he was hunting. The incident is being investigated as a possible murder. Most of the residents in Bardstown are afraid. The police are not really...
checked for a pulse to do some CPR, and when the paramedics arrived, he knew that she couldn't be saved. But he added, I knew if they had brought her back, she's going to suffer massive brain damage, and she'd never be the same again.
Yeah, but nobody really thinks that way in a crisis. You just want to save your loved one no matter what.
Yeah, you don't even have that thought cross your mind. It's
strange.
No.
Well, weird thing was that after this interview, a lot of people from the community just called in and said, take a look at him. We think he did it. Yeah. So he didn't come across well in this interview at all.
He must not have represented himself very well in that interview.
No, people didn't like him. And the host brought up statistics that say that 8 to 9 out of 10 murder victims know their attacker. Then he asked Joe if he thought Rachel knew her killer. And Joe said yes, and he added, everyone, including myself, is a suspect until this is solved. So that was kind of strange. I guess you'd acknowledge that. I don't know.
Well, I mean, I guess you have to in a sense.
It might not be that strange.
The proverbial elephant in the room. Everybody who does any crime shows and stuff knows that a spouse or significant other is one of the big suspects.
Absolutely. The first one.
So he's got to bring that up first.
Right, right. Now, he was staying at his mother's house and keeping his sons with him. And then after the crime scene had been processed, he was given the keys back to their house in Naul. But he wasn't shy about talking to the media at all. He went through the details of the day Rachel died over and over, offering up some theories as well. For example, on October 21st, reporter Jenny Friel went to the house to interview him. Now, she's the one who ended up authoring a book on the crime that we read, titled The Suspect.
Yes.
And I'd highly recommend this book. It was a fascinating look at this really planned out and brutal case.
It was a good, well-written story. Yes.
Yeah. So I would recommend it, because she actually was there and talked to Joe. So she went to the house and interviewed him. And she would write that he seemed like an ordinary, polite guy, and at first she really thought that he was innocent. And to the outside world, he seemed normal, affable, but the facts would show that he had spent some time planning Rachel's murder, carried it out with extreme brutality, and then faced those who loved her, pretending to be the grieving widower. So Joe went over the day of Rachel's death with Friel, describing gruesome details in a calm, matter-of-fact way. He told her that Rachel's head had been stuck to the carpet with a large amount of blood from her head wounds. Then he showed her their wedding album, and she said that was the only part of the interview when he showed some emotion. His eyes welled up with tears, and he said it had been a long time since he'd looked at those photos. So maybe he was really feeling bad looking back at when he really cared about her.
But I came home from work, and there's my lovely wife, Jill, chopping up carrots and stuff. And I said to her, Jill, what are you doing? She says, well, I'm making dinner. And I kind of laughed and said, but you don't cook. And Jill said, but I do now. I got this HelloFresh stuff.
I was excited. Yeah.
And so she's cooking away. And she made this delicious meal of mushroom lo mein, had carrots in it and stuff. It was great. What a wonderful meal. So then I'm thinking, wow, this is great. This is something that novice cooks can do. Or even experienced cooks that might be short on time. It's a good way to do it.
Yeah.
It's very simple to use. There's very detailed instructions. Everything's measured out in exact quantities. So there's no waste.
I really like that. It's earth-friendly.
Me too. And the ingredients are all the freshest ones. The other thing I think is cool is that they have a full-time registered dietitian who reviews each recipe to ensure that it is a nutritionally balanced recipe.
That's so, really good. If you're trying to really pay attention to your health, or if you have kids, it would be super nice.
Wouldn't it?
Yeah. Like having your own personal dietitian, almost.
It almost is. No. That's what it reminds me of.
Yeah.
You know the meal you're getting is something that's been vetted and looked on as a good meal. Not just a good tasting meal, but a good healthy meal.
Right.
So.
And it's not automatic. You pick what you want when you want. And they even have an app for your mobile phone. I would recommend people try it.
People got to try it.
So once again, that's HelloFresh.com/TCB to get $35 off. So let's go back to our Rachel O'Reilly.
Back to Rachel.
Rachel's case. So Rachel's mother, Rose, thought that Rachel remained loyal to Joe. She loved Joe, Rose told a reporter, and she would have looked over anything that made him look bad. But 9 days before Rachel's death, according to Rachel's friend Jackie, Rachel said that she had given Joe an ultimatum. He'd gone off to England, and Rachel had spoken to him on the phone. No more late-night inspections, she told him, or she would go ahead and get a divorce. But things didn't improve after that. Now, the Sunday before Rachel was murdered, she and Joe had an argument, and Rachel confronted Joe about his affair after he heard her children mention Daddy's friend Nikki, referring to his mistress. So he'd even introduced her to the children.
This is pretty brazen.
It is. But Joe slept in the spare room as usual, and then he left at 5:40 a.m. for the gym, and Rachel woke a couple of hours later for a busy day ahead on the day she died. And it was like any other Monday. But it would only be 2 more hours after she did this that she would be beaten to death in her own home.